Are we ready? Okay, good stuff. Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2023. Our first item on the agenda this morning is to hear evidence on the Budget 2023-24. And can I welcome our first panel of witnesses, Shirley Ann Somerville, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, and Graham Logan, Director of Learning from the Scottish Government. Good morning. Thank you for joining us today. And we will begin with a short opening statement from yourself, Cabinet Secretary. You have up to 3 minutes.
Thank you, Convener. As I highlighted previously, this current budget is taking place in a turbulent economic context, and the Scottish Government is not immune from that turbulence, and we continue to take decisions that will achieve the greatest impact on the outcomes we are seeking to achieve. At a macro scale, that means adopting a firm focus on tackling child poverty, creating a wellbeing economy with a just transition to net zero, and ensuring the sustainability of first-class public services. With those outcomes in mind, you will be aware of my recent statement regarding our commitment to protect teacher and support staff numbers and the current number of learning hours for children. As I said in the Chamber, I remain grateful to our colleagues in local government for their dedication to the delivery of a first-class education service for our children and young people. For example, we remain close to record levels of teacher numbers, and our pupil-teacher ratio remains historically low at 13.2. Last year, we witnessed the biggest single decrease in the attainment gap in primary numeracy and literacy levels since records began. Equally, I understand the difficult budgetary choices local government faces. However, it is my responsibility as Education Secretary to ensure that we have the fundamentals in place to build on the current success. That is why we have funded new financial commitments around the funding we provided for teacher numbers and pupil support staff. In particular, this is to at least maintain teacher numbers at current levels in the year ahead, while working towards the delivery of our commitment to increase teacher numbers by 3,500 by the end of the Parliament. Maintaining the number of school support staff at their current levels and continuing to ensure that places are available for probationary teachers who need them on the teacher induction scheme. In addition, you will have seen the reports that some councils were considering a reduction to the length of the school week. There is already a statutory provision that pupils must receive 190 school days per year, but I am concerned that a reduction in learning hours would materially reduce pupil attainment and wellbeing. For that reason, I will commence the provision in the Education Scotland Act 2016, which enables ministers to set the minimum number of learning hours in a school year. Following thorough consultation, I will then bring forward regulations that will specify the minimum number of learning hours per annum and effectively provide a statutory basis for the pupil week. There is currently some limited variation in delivery across Scotland, and this has arisen for a range of reasons, and it will need to be fully explored through the consultation and considered before regulations are laid. These regulations will be subject to affirmative parliamentary procedure. Finally, I wanted to take the opportunity to update you briefly on the teacher pay negotiations. Notwithstanding financial challenges, the Scottish Government has demonstrated our commitment to teachers to provide a fair pay offer in 2022-23 and is now providing further additional funding to enable the two-year pay deal offer to teachers. This offer will provide the most experienced teachers at the top of the main pay grade scale, 70% of all teachers, a pay increase of over 5,000 compared to January 22. In comparison to the previous offer, this new offer significantly increases the financial envelope with an overall cumulative increase of 11.83% for the majority of staff over 2 years. Although some other unions are consulting their members at present, you will have seen the EIS has already rejected this enhancement. And while I'm obviously disappointed, it goes without saying that the current disruption is extremely difficult for young people, parents and carers, and I will continue to do everything I can to secure a deal that is fair and affordable for all. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much for that statement. Can I move to opening questions from Graham Day, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I want to go back, if I may, to what has triggered all of this, namely how an additional sum of £145.5 million given for the purpose of increasing teacher and wellness support assistant numbers was used or not by local authorities, because there's been a lot of muddying of the water being attempted over this, Cabinet Secretary. And I think there are two things lost in all of this. One is I think we should acknowledge that there were eight councils and the grant-aided sector did use the money for the purpose it was given and have increased their numbers, but clearly the majority of councils haven't. And I just want to explore with you what the government has ascertained in terms of how the monies were used at local authority level. I have knowledge of one council where, as you say, it's Angus Council, where the sums that were given were deployed to add 28 full-time equivalent teachers and 10 learning support assistants. However, their numbers have gone down by 27 overall, which gives the impression that they have clearly not replaced posts that already existed, temporary and permanent. But also an admission that it would appear £1 million of that money was allocated, a strategic proposal was made, they tell me, to deliver, to meet the costs of a saving that the council was making. So obviously not for that purpose. Can I ask, and apologies for the long-winded intro, convener, can I ask, is that pretty typical of what the government has found most councils utilise the monies for?
Well, I think to point out, first of all, how the money was allocated in 22-23, the money was given over with the understanding it would be used for teacher numbers and pupil support staff. That was indeed our expectation as we went through the year. We have and continue to receive reassurances from COSLA that it was spent on education and it was spent on issues surrounding education, particularly teacher numbers. But clearly, obviously, I'd be happy to, if Mr. Day would like to pass on a copy of that letter from Angus Council to let me see the details of that, because clearly councils will vary council by council, but the overall reassurance from COSLA that the money was spent in education is something that we had to take on good faith. Clearly, when the teacher census numbers came out, there was obviously then a concern that may not have been the case in every situation. And therefore, that's why, looking forward, we are very keen to ensure that we have further monitoring placed to actually ensure that we get from that money what we expect, which is at least maintaining teacher numbers and pupil support staff numbers over the year ahead. But I'd be happy to receive that letter and look into it in further detail if Mr. Day would wish to pass it on.
Yeah, and I appreciate that, Cabinet Secretary, but it does appear pretty clear when one looks through the list of numbers for each council, the vast majority, so their teacher numbers go down. So it clearly wasn't used for the purpose for which it was given in the majority of cases.
Well, the numbers overall went down by 92, and it does vary from local authority. And I would also say, again, in fairness to local authority colleagues, some of the numbers go down by very small amounts, and some of that may be for genuine recruitment and retention issues, particularly in rural remote areas or in specific subjects. So there is, I think, a real need for us to look very carefully at this, and to work with local authorities and councils as we go through this process to ensure that we are cognizant of some of the challenges that they may face in particular areas or in particular subjects that may lead to numbers going down by quite a small number, but not for strategic decisions made by the council, but genuine recruitment challenges. And I think I would separate those two out. So some of the reductions were small, and some of them may have been due to those practical issues. But clearly, that's still a concern. And also, of course, what we did have to bear in mind was, and I accept they were proposals from officers, not decisions that were made by councils, but some of the proposals that were coming forward were really quite grave in what they would mean for teacher numbers and for pupil support staff numbers. And it was on that basis, not just looking at the teacher census for last year, which did see that small decrease, that I was very keen to take action. So both looking at it historically for the previous year, but also at some of the proposals from officers for the year ahead.
Thank you. I'm conscious of our time. Can I move now to Stephen Kerr, please?
Cabinet Secretary, good morning. Sticking with the £145.5 million, you've used words like understanding, expectation in relation to the agreement that you and John Swinney made. Well, I used the word agreement, I'll come back to that word, in the summer of 2021, that this money would be effectively made core to local authorities for the purposes that you've described. Was that simply a verbal agreement? Was there an exchange of memos or letters? Was anything actually set down that can be referred to in terms of a future accountability. How was that done? And I'll put this in context. In my previous life, before I became a politician, lots of multi-million pound deals were done, but they were never done on the basis of a verbal agreement. They were always done on the basis of some pretty solid paperwork.
I don't think it was private in any way how I spent that, how I thought that money should be spent. I can remember discussing it a great deal in Parliament. It was very public how that money was to be spent. And similar, the discussions with COSLA would go on at that level as well. So I said it in Parliament, we'd say it directly to COSLA. And of course, the money then went from the Scottish Government to the Settlement Distribution Group, which had to then decide how it would be divided between the 32 local authorities. So I don't think there's any dubiety about how...
But isn't there anything substantive in terms of an agreement that you had reached about the 105? I mean, was it simply verbally agreed? You're saying, you're referring to the official report of the proceedings of Parliament, etc. I get all that, and I agree with you that your expectations were well described. But when you're making an agreement with COSLA, surely it has to be set out in some specific detail that that expectation is this, and here's the accountability.
Yes, I'd be happy to provide further written detail on that.
Right.
I mean, I certainly said no dubiety either in public, in private, with government, with Parliament, or with COSLA, how the money would be
that
spent.
That is very useful. If you're willing to share any documentation around that is very useful. And moving on to the 100 million that was announced yesterday in the budget that's going to local authorities, that money is to be used exclusively, or is expected to be used, so we've got to use the right language here. The 100 million is expected to be used to increase the salaries of non-teaching education staff. That's correct, isn't it?
Yes.
And this money is part of the Barnett consequentials, the adjustments that come at the financial year end. That's where that money's coming from, yes?
The £100 million is part of the settlement for next year,
the
for 23-24.
Yeah.
But the Deputy First Minister made it clear that there were very late changes to the 22-23 budget, which allowed him to use some of that to assist with the 23-24 budget.
So I'm correct in saying that
we're agreeing with each other.
Yes, I agree that this is the normal run-of-the-mill stuff, that there is an adjustment at the end of the year. And this 100 million has gone to the non-teaching education staff. So I come back to a question, and I'm genuinely seeking to understand this, because one of the great defences that is deployed quite frequently against those of us in opposition who ask questions of government about spending is, well, if you want to spend more money in this area, where are you going to take this money from? So last week, you announced this £156 million split between this year and next year that's going to be used to fund the teachers' the offer. Where did that money come from?
As I think the Deputy First Minister tried to explain to you yesterday, Mr Kerr, in the Chamber, £33 million of that comes from the 22-23 budget. That has been done with exceptional difficulty and not without consequences to ensure that we could improve the offer for 22-23. So that is £33 million of
that. That's generic savings.
It comes from the decisions that we've taken from savings and analysing the money that we have 22-23 to ensure
this
that we
can... This is on the back of the announcement John Swinney made last year about how he was clawing back money and seeking savings from all of his cabinet colleagues.
Well, there wasn't just one announcement. There was a series of announcements of the changes that we had to make. So those are the types of challenges that the Deputy First Minister has understandably made to all cabinet colleagues to see what could be done to initiate savings.
For next year,
the £123 million comes from the Education and Skills budget.
So that money was already there?
The money is in the budget for next year, and it has to now be found to be spent on teachers' pay.
So there are cuts in education and skills budget for 23-24. That money is being moved from somewhere in your budget to local government to pay for this new offer.
I will have to find that money in year to assist with it. I go back to the point that I've made all along in the teachers' pay dispute. if we increase the capacity for local government to improve their offer as the employers, the money needs to be found, and it is not without consequence. So that money will be found from the education and skills budget.
Mr. Kerr, are you looking for what the consequences are?
Yeah, I am looking for the consequences. Where is that going to be cut?
Well, I will have to analyse that and make those decisions in year to ensure that the education and skills balance will budget. But clearly, Mr. Kerr, you've been demanding that I take action to improve the pay offer. I've made clear to you every single time that the only way that can be done is by the money being increased.
I'm not sure that I'm as powerful as to be responsible for what you decide in
thank
government.
You, Mr.
No, but then you have to understand the consequences of that, Mr. Kerr.
One small point, Mr. Kerr, before we move on.
This is deeply concerning. Because what you're telling us in the final moments of this budget process is that you're going to cut other education and skills programmes to the tune of £110 million, and we don't know what the details of that is, and you don't know what they are either.
Well, with the greatest respect, Mr. Kerr, for the entirety of this teachers' pay dispute, I have said that if the money is increased, it will have to come from somewhere. No. So I genuinely don't know how this is a surprise to you, because the balance has to be found within the budget.
I'm hearing all of that, and that's a traditional defence, and I get that. That's your traditional defence.
Okay. No, but you don't have the details
of where the money is going to be cut from at this moment.
I think
we will have to work through that in year.
The Cabinet Secretary has answered that. I think the answer is no.
Well, we need to know what
details
means as you go along, because at the minute you don't know.
Well, and indeed, every single time, Mr. Kerr, you demand that I put a new offer on the table,
Cabinet Secretary, Mr. Kerr, can I move to questions now from Michael Marra, please?
Thank you very much, Convener. On the 18th of December, the Deputy First Minister, John Swinney, issued his budget circular to COSLA. On the 18th of January, you, Cabinet Secretary, were here in front of us giving details on the budget. On the 1st of February, you wrote a letter to COSLA, ring-fencing one-third of their net revenue budget and demanding that they get back to you by 5 p.m, telling them how they were going to deal with that, whether they would accept it or not. Can you tell us, within those periods between your appearance here and your letter on the 1st of February, what changed your mind?
So clearly, as soon as the teacher census numbers came out, I was concerned about that and wrote very quickly after the teacher census numbers to COSLA, raising my concerns suggesting that we met with urgency to discuss the teacher census numbers, to discuss this issue, and then clearly we moved forward with discussions with COSLA on these issues. Now, while those private discussions were happening with COSLA to see whether we could find a way of not coming forward in the way that we have with the proposals that I have now, but to see if there was a way where we could find a goodwill understanding where the teacher numbers wouldn't be cut, those discussions went on in private. When it became clear to me that unfortunately further action would have to be taken, then that was when we changed from the policy that we had in 22-23, which was an understanding of how that money would be spent, to what will happen in 23-24, which is to ensure that that money is spent that way and to initiate clawback if ministers decide. So there was an ongoing private discussion, as I hope people would appreciate that we should do with COSLA, all the way from the teacher census publication in December through to the letter that was then sent through officially about how that would be done.
And your questions on these issues, both in the Chamber and here in committee, in terms of the teacher numbers, and you did not, I don't think at that point, say that there was any mechanism or push to try and resolve it. But on, as I say, within those days, between the 18th of January and the 1st of February, you resolved to ring-fence an entirety of one-third of the net revenue budget of councils across Scotland. Now, the Chief Executive Association, SOLAS, in councils, had said that at that point it was impossible for them, at no notice, by 5 p.m, in one working day, to rewrite their budgets. Do you think this is a way that the Scottish Government should be running not just education, but frankly its finances?
Well, as I say, the letter was the final piece in a number of meetings which took place between Scottish Government, both at a ministerial level with COSLA spokespeople and also at official letter, before that final opportunity was given to see if more could be done in a different way. And that was why we were very clear that we wanted to see progress, but we were very clear with COSLA that that could be done in a number of different ways. Unfortunately, I did come to the conclusion that this was required. And the reason that was required was obviously from the teacher census, which sparked concerns about what happened in the previous year. We also then had local government, and I again say, for clarity, these are proposals from officers, but we saw a number of councils coming out with proposals for the 23-24 budget that were exceptionally concerning about what it would mean for teacher numbers. So if you put those two things together, then were on a trajectory.
You've already said this, Cabinet Secretary, if I can, so you're repeating the first answer. And I just want to try and understand how you have moved within that period. I mean, you can't think that this is an optimum and desirable situation. I mean, this is chaos in councils, where the decision for taking one-third of the entirety of their budgeting options. You know, we could have a discussion about whether we think that that's a good thing or not about teacher numbers, but where they're left is having to make massive cuts in other parts. So, for instance, if I can, one example, the Big Noise Douglas in Dundee, an education programme that works with kids in the most impoverished area, is about to be cut by Dundee City Council. They are left in that position where they're making this cut. Do you think that that's a reasonable position that you've put them in with just weeks to go, days to go before setting a budget?
Well, a couple of things I would say to that. Overall, local authorities spend £6.4 billion on education, so I would put that figure in to give some balance to some of the numbers that you've raised. The other thing I would say, two points. If we didn't come in as a government and do something that would protect teacher numbers, I have a funny feeling that opposition parties would be jumping up and down. In fact, indeed, they were at First Minister's question.
It's precisely my point, Kabir.
Mr. Mann, if you would actually let me answer the question. What was the alternative to protect teacher numbers? Now, we tried very hard with local authorities to find out what that would be, but that was a challenging conversation that we were unable to come to any conclusion that I had to take the action that I did. There's no other alternative that I have in front of me or has been presented to me that would have protected teacher numbers. The final point I would make on that as well, again, we have just concluded the budget process yesterday. At no point in that did any opposition party come forward with costed plans on if they wanted the amount that was given to local government to increase, how that would be done. So again, it's more demands about money being spent, but little to none suggestions coming forward about where that money would come from. And I'm afraid that is the reality of the situation, is the lack of alternatives, Mr. Mara.
I'm afraid, because it wasn't an answer to either of the questions that I asked. I mean, this is a situation, I think, which can only really be described as solace, as chaos. You know, this is a complete failure of planning on behalf of the government to deal with a fundamental issue in terms of teacher numbers over the long term to ensure that that was maintained. I mean, it strikes me that the one thing that seems to have changed is that the First Minister was challenged on television on this very issue on the 30th of January.
Is there a question?
Is that why you changed between the 30th of January and the 1st of February?
Not when there are letters coming from myself to COSLA straight after the teacher census. So, no, okay. Mr. Well, Mara. I think you're trying to suggest something when actually the discussions on this started right after the teacher census. And I would point out to teacher numbers still being at a near record high in Scotland.
Thank you. Just again on that subject of the timeline, I suppose, I was in discussions with West Lothian councillors earlier on this week, and they spoke about how they've been consulting on their budget since September. And the last minute change that came has resulted, I think, well, I don't want to preempt anything, but they've got their budget today. It could be just down to a council tax increase given the short notice. They were also concerned that there hadn't yet been a decision on the schools for future funding, which was meant to be announced in December. I was wondering if you could maybe update us on that.
Certainly. So in terms of the budget proposals that come from local authorities, I totally appreciate that the work for that goes on for a number of months before anything comes to councils themselves. Again, I go back to the point that the teacher census comes out at the start of December. That was when we had the information that showed that we had the reduction in teacher numbers. So I completely appreciate that councils have been working on it, but if the material and the information that we get out is in December, that's when we immediately began to take action. I'm very conscious of the fact that we have said previously that we would make the announcement on the LEAP next stage. I have been looking at that very carefully, and I do hope to make an announcement on that soon. But it would be fair to say that a number of local authorities have came forward with a number of proposals, all good quality proposals that passed the criteria, and therefore I am giving it due and serious consideration. I appreciate that's difficult for councils, but I also hope they appreciate that it is because I recognise the real significance to them of the decisions that we would take on this, that I'm taking some more time to look at that, given the number of proposals that came in.
Okay, thank you. Can we move to questions now from Ross Greer, please?
Don't have questions in this session, convener.
Apologies. It's Mr. Bob Dorris, please.
Thanks very much, convener. So I'm just looking at teacher numbers, and I've seen Glasgow, thankfully, in 2021, 2022, over 100 new teachers appointed, so positive news in Glasgow, but overall across Scotland, a 0.2% dip in teacher numbers across all schools. But I'm not quite sure what the baseline is for judging progress from, so I'd like to take you, Cabinet Secretary, to the non-recurring funds that were given to local authorities, which between July 2020, August 2020 and March 2021 came to £140 million for more teachers and teaching assistants at the height of COVID to do all we could to support schools and education. And of course, then we come on to recurring funds, roughly the same total. So do we have data on how many teachers or teaching assistants was employed in July, following the July 2020, the August 2020 or the March 2021 non-recurring funds, because that would allow us to compare where we were before the recurring funds were given and how the non-recurring funds were spent for that one particular year.
So, yes, we do. Again, I'd be happy to provide some information about how the money has been spent. There was clearly an increase in the number of teachers that we've had. So if you look at 2021, we had 54,285. That was the reduction of 92. But if you compare that to the previous year, where we saw 53,400 teachers. So what we have seen overall is an increase from the pre-pandemic levels to where we are now of an additional 2,000 teachers that have came through. Now, in terms of how the money was given to councils, there were, for COVID money, and this was before the baseline, there was two parts of that money. And we did see certainly an increase in the number of teachers that we were seeing in employment, particularly from that first batch of COVID money. It's then quite challenging to know whether the second batch of money was spent to improve the number of teachers and pupil support assistants again, as we might have thought. Now, it was COVID money, and there were a number of ways that that could have been spent. So, I would say to councils there was more flexibility for them at that point. But again, happy to provide the information about the breakdown over the years and the breakdown about our expectations about where that money was spent.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. A lot in that, and really without seeing it written down, we can't really analyse it as a committee, to be fair. When we get that information, will government be absolutely clear where the baseline is from which the Scottish Government will be judged in terms of maintaining teacher numbers, increasing teacher numbers, and likewise with teaching support assistants? Will that be
crystal clear when we get that information?
Yeah, I mean, it will all be from the census, in essence. The census is the national statistics that come forward on teacher numbers, and the numbers on pupil support are not published in December, which I've been referring to previously. They're actually published in March. So when you look at where the baseline is for each of the years and where those numbers came from that I quoted, it's from the teacher census.
OK. And final question, I look forward to getting those figures to committee. We want to scrutinise that. Final question. In the early days of this committee, there was discussion around schools and local authorities employing temporary teachers and assistants quickly, as quickly as they could, to support education through COVID on temporary contracts. They weren't necessarily at the right education facility with the right skill set where you'd want them to be going forward. What monitoring does the government do in relation to temporary contracts in those early days at the height of COVID, and where we'll be going forward?
So one of the key challenges, I had a number of discussions in the chamber, I think particularly with Mr Rennie, on the issue of temporary and permanent staff, and one of the points that was continuously raised to me by local authorities was it was difficult to move from temporary to permanent because the money wasn't permanent, it wasn't baselined, and that was why we moved from COVID money to permanent. Now, we look at that again through the teacher census to see what happens there. And there clearly wasn't the movement that we wanted in that, because I would have hoped, expected, that we would have seen an increase in the number of permanent contracts. Because very understandably, because the money was temporary and because of the urgency of getting people in, the number of temporary contracts was high during COVID. I would have hoped and did expect for that to change. Again, we haven't seen that happening, but it is something which I'm keen to work with local government on to see what can be done on that issue as well.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Doris. Can I move now to Ruth Maguire, please?
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to ask about fairness and consistency in terms of local authorities managing localised needs and their changing needs, for example, falling roles. If I give the example of my local area, North Ayrshire's experiencing a decline in population, and with that a declining pupil role. Now that's reflected through reduction in the grant aided expenditure. Can I just ask if councils with an increasing pupil role would receive additional funding through the grant aided expenditure, but would not have to increase number of teachers, only maintain them at 2022 levels?
Well, certainly what we're looking at for the letter which I've just put out around teacher numbers. Yes, I do recognise that there are some local authorities where pupil numbers have decreased and are expected to decrease, and we've got some local authorities that will see an increase in their pupil numbers. And clearly, you could therefore keep the pupil-teacher ratio the same in certain local authorities with a reduction in teachers. That would be something which local authorities could look at. I think the challenge that we have, though, is that if we are also looking at improving attainment, then it's clear that it would be useful, and the research again backs this and supports it from the OECD, that teacher numbers and teacher quality has an impact on attainment, and therefore just because the pupil role is going down is not necessarily a reason to reduce teacher numbers, particularly if you're looking at how you can support those that are perhaps from poorest communities, perhaps that are struggling within schools for whatever reason, and you can use those teachers in different ways. So yes, the pupil-teacher ratio is important, but so is how the overall teaching workforce has been used. But clearly, when it comes to expenditure, whether the pupil numbers go up or the pupil numbers go down does have an impact on the funding that goes forward to local authorities.
Convener, if you'll forgive me for staying with North Ayrshire as the example, obviously these are the figures that I know, and I think it will it will be relevant for other areas of Scotland as well. Talking about the attainment challenge, North Ayrshire was obviously one of the areas that lost funding. And, you know, we've had that debate, and I would absolutely recognise that there's poverty everywhere, and attainment challenge funding needs to be provided across Scotland. However, the local authority employed an additional 17 teachers for that. Their funding has been reduced, so they need to find that money from elsewhere. I just wonder what assessment has been made by the Scottish Government of, and I recognise what the Cabinet Secretary says about teacher numbers, they are important, but when we talk about the poverty-related attainment gap for children and families in my constituency having good services such as libraries and leisure centres, these types of things are also crucial for their opportunities. Can I ask what assessment has been made in terms of that?
So obviously when it comes to the challenge authorities, that is why we have parts of the letter from myself to local authorities which recognise that there may be exceptional circumstances that we need to take into account. So I mentioned recruitment and retention earlier on. The changes to challenge authorities would be another one of those that we would take cognisant of. And I think when it comes down to the difficult decisions that local authorities have to make, I fully appreciate, I said in my opening statement, that local authorities do have a very difficult decision to take, just as the Scottish Government did as we put our budget together as well. But if we have, and it is a joint understanding of that desire to improve attainment, I've yet to see any suggestions coming forward that reductions in teacher numbers and reductions in pupil support assistance would help close the poverty-related attainment gap. If we want to get those education fundamentals in place, that's why we have to take the decisions. And particularly if we have a joint understanding about why money has been put into a budget, I don't think it is surprising that local government would wish to provide further challenge to local authorities to ensure that that money was spent in that type of way if that understanding had been there. Now, clearly, then, there are decisions for local authorities to make as to other areas of their expenditure. Those are very difficult, but it goes back to the point that we made earlier on when we're discussing the budget that was set yesterday. The Deputy First Minister brought forward additional expenditure for local government, now over £700 million for that, and that is a substantial increase, again in real terms, for local government, and the decisions that we have taken and have allowed that to happen. And as I've mentioned earlier, there were no costed proposals which came forward from elsewhere in the Parliament to suggest how that would be increased.
Moving for the next, I'm conscious of the time and I know you've got one more. Can the Cabinet Secretary also keep her answers as concise as possible, please? Thank you.
Convener, thank you. And I appreciate the Cabinet Secretary's answer there, and particularly you mentioned around exceptional circumstances. I think we'd all acknowledge that reducing teacher numbers, there's no evidence that would assist in reducing the poverty-related attainment gap. But I suspect that we may have a case in North Ayrshire where there's actually a surplus of teachers, and perhaps that's somewhere that the Scottish Government could look to, not looking for additional funding, but could look to the specific circumstances of the area so that we are taking a fair and consistent approach that benefits the children in schools there. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I think there are different ways about how to use a teaching workforce, and you know, that can be done in a myriad of different ways. Again, for brevity, it could be for supporting pupils with additional support. It could be looking at smaller group work that assists with numeracy and literacy. So I don't see them as a surplus teachers. I see them as the teaching workforce that can be used by a local authority to assist children in a variety of ways as the local authority sees fit, particularly to try and improve the attainment.
Thank you. Can we move now to questions from Co-Cab Stewart, Ms. Convener, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Just continuing on the theme of workforce planning, I'm interested to get a bit of insight on the Communications that you may or may not have had with the Teacher Workforce Planning Advisory Group on consultations that may have occurred regarding that 3,500 figure. So it'd just be good to know about that. Yeah.
So there is a great deal of work that goes on to try and model what happens with the teacher workforce. This isn't something that the Scottish Government undertakes alone. There's clearly a lot of work that goes in with stakeholders on this. The model that's used that does look at, for example, the number that has to go into ITE to maintain pupil-teacher ratios obviously looks at the number of teachers that are currently in the system, retirements, the number of people that are returning maternity and so on. There is obviously then a group that looks at that, not just government, as I say, that involves the universities, it involves the funding councils, it involves the GTCS, importantly it involves the teachers' union. So there's a great deal of work, and also obviously local authorities as the employers, I shouldn't forget to mention them. So there's a number of stakeholders that sit round and look at the best modelling that can be done, and it is modelling and forecasting, to see about the number of teachers that will leave the workforce, the number of teachers that may have to come into the workforce, and obviously groups such as those will also analyse what has to be done to assist government with the proposals that we have, supported by the Bute House Agreement for additional teachers.
Okay. So that's how the initial teacher education programmes are sort of like the intake is determined. I think I get that clearly. So do you think that there is capacity in the ITE courses to meet the government target?
The government target absolutely remains for that 3,500 by the end of the year. Now, clearly, we have to work with local government colleagues once budgets are set to analyse further projections in year, so, and we need to obviously look at what the ITE numbers will be as well. So that is not a kind of one-stage process, it's an iterative process that goes on during the year, but the government commitment remains on those numbers.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. On that, in terms of the recruiting those additional teachers, which, as we say, we're all supporting, there's been a lot in terms of the environment that the teachers are operating in at the moment in terms of the violence, etc. So do you think that in order to achieve the numbers and really attract people into the profession, serious changes have to be made with the teacher contracts?
Well, changes to teacher contracts would be an issue for the SNCT to look at, which obviously the government is part of, but only one part of, quite rightly. So that would be something for the SNCT to consider, and that meets on a regular basis. Now, unsurprisingly, at the moment, the agenda of SNCT is taken up by the teachers' pay dispute, but clearly we still have ongoing discussions bilaterally also with teaching unions, as well as through the SNCT about a number of issues, workforce, workload, the impacts on staff and their mental health and wellbeing and so on.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Can I move to questions now? You finished?
Yes.
So I'm just checking, sorry. Stephanie Callaghan, please. You're on.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, you've already touched on this in your response to Ruth there, and I'm going to roll it into one. I'm quite mindful of time. We're all clear that narrowing the poverty-related attainment gap is a key education priority. So firstly, can I ask you to outline the role that teachers play in narrowing that gap? Secondly, can I ask if we're seeing results from investing in teaching numbers? And finally, what impact would you see cutting teaching numbers have?
So I think I mentioned earlier on, I mean, teachers are one part, but an exceptionally important part of reducing the poverty-related attainment gap. As again, I said earlier on, we've seen an increase of 2,000 teachers since pre-pandemic levels. And absolutely, as in other countries, the attainment levels overall have been impacted by COVID. But what we have seen, and I think that is in large part due to the exceptional hard work of teachers and support staff, we have seen improvements in the attainment gap. So the biggest single year decrease in the attainment gap in primary numeracy and literacy since levels began. So yes, we still have more work to do, absolutely, on that. But we have seen recovery in place, and I'd say that would absolutely, in large part, be down to the teachers. There's a number of ways that that can be done. I pointed to some of those earlier. It's not just about one teacher in front of a class, but it's the specialist work that's being done by teachers for small groups of pupils. It's the support for those with additional special needs and so on. So there are a number of ways that that can be done. And importantly, also within that is the quality of the teaching and learning. So it's not possible to say that there is one thing that improves attainment. Yes, there are different aspects to that, but I hope we would agree that the teachers are an integral part of that, and that's why the government has placed such importance on increasing teacher numbers and also obviously the decisions that I've taken to ensure that we don't see decreases in teacher numbers and that those numbers are maintained over the year.
So what impact would you actually see cutting teaching numbers having directly on closing the attainment gap?
Well, again, for brevity, I'll simply briefly restate something I said earlier on. I've not seen any research that would suggest that cutting teacher numbers or indeed learning hours where children are in a school would improve attainment. So I think the obligation within government is to do all we can to try and ensure that numbers are maintained, if not improved.
I think our committee report on the attainment challenge made it quite clear that it was a very complex issue and it's maybe not quite as binary as one contributing factor. Can we move now to questions from Willie Rennie, please?
Thanks very much, convener. So talk me through this. If a council ignores your warning, and you, what happens next? What's the process?
So as we go through the year, we are working with local authorities to put in monitoring arrangements. So one of the challenges that we had was that the figures came out in December, which showed the problem. And we, because this was an agreement with local authorities without additional monitoring, we didn't have in-year monitoring last year. So we want to improve on that situation. We're all still looking at how that will be done. Probably going to be on a quarterly basis, and that will flag up when we have issues in year with local authorities. But as I say, those discussions with COSLA are still ongoing, because what we don't want to have is an over-onerous monitoring process where it's continuous. Also recognising that numbers will go up and down because of recruitment and retention at different parts of the year. So if we see an issue in year, clearly that will begin at officer and official level about raising concerns about that, looking at the reasons for that, particular challenges in different areas. And if that has to be escalated to myself, having discussions with that particular council, then that would happen. If we get to the point where that still hasn't been improved by end of year, then the money can be withheld, last tranche can be withheld from the council at that point. But that is absolutely the last case scenario that we don't want to get to, and we want to work with local authorities in year to understand their specific circumstances. So there's no blanket approach to this.
Okay, so let's say you've got clear evidence that the council in concern has ignored your warnings, that they've cut teacher numbers, you withdraw the funding. What does the council do next? What happens if they, for instance, decide as a result of that cut, they have to make further cuts in teachers? Will you impose a further penalty on the council? How does that work?
Well, I think it's been very clearly laid out that we would withhold the last tranches of funding if councils don't follow through on this. And I think that is an important aspect to that. Now, clearly, there will be implications for councils in that, which is the whole point of having a system where there is something in place to attempt to prevent councils from reducing teacher numbers. Now, again, that's not a blanket approach, and there may be reasons why teacher numbers go down, which in which case we would not have any financial penalties to local authorities. But we've been very clear right from the start that there would be a financial penalty if there is seen to be a more strategic decision to reduce teacher numbers, and there will be implications for councils for that.
So is it possible that we could end up with even fewer teachers at the end of this process if you proceed with penalising councils that believe they've got no other choice but to cut teacher numbers? Is that a possible scenario that could happen?
I think because we will work very closely and very carefully with local authorities in year, there will be a very clear understanding from local authorities about what will happen and the implications for that. And it's for local authorities to then weigh up about whether that would be sensible to carry on strategically cutting student teacher numbers, because they would know the implications for that. So I don't think we would get to that situation, no, because I think through the collaboration that we will have in year, they would be very clear about the implications for that and how that would might not make financial sense for the council to do that.
I understand that you don't want to get to this and you want to have a collaborative approach. That's what you've been trying to do for years and it hasn't apparently succeeded. But I'm just curious as to how you think withdrawing more funding from a council will help them balance their budget and get the appropriate number of staff in the right schools. Will it not end up undermining the objective that you set yourself at the beginning, that we'll end up with fewer teachers, fewer classroom assistants? I mean, these councils don't want to do this. I mean, they are facing, you know, the really difficult financial challenges. You've acknowledged that yourself. So I just don't understand why the penalty helps anybody in this scenario. They are not the enemy. They are trying to do their best. And your penalty might make it even worse.
Well, what I would point to actually is something that you said in your question, which I'll challenge, if I may. We haven't been doing the 22-23 approach for years. That was 1 year we tried that. Actually, what we had up until 2018-19 was exactly the system that we're now putting back in place. And during that time, no council got to the stage of actually having a financial penalty. And I think that proves that the situation worked, and I would anticipate that to be happening again. So actually, when you look at what we have done for years, it is actually what we are just about to reintroduce. And I don't want to see this, I would hasten to add, being in place for years. I would want to get to a different situation for the next financial year. But when you look at what happened historically, this was actually what was in place, and not one single council in any of those years got to the point of financial penalty.
But there's no point in having the threat of a penalty if you're not prepared to contemplate the consequences of that penalty. So you've got to accept that we could end up with a scenario where councils have even less funds and therefore cannot employ as many teachers as they would like, so it would be a further cut in teacher numbers. You've got to accept that that's a possibility with this penalty.
Well, you're looking at a hypothetical situation in the future.
Yes, I am, because you've set it out.
And I'm looking at the evidence of what's happened in the past, in that that has not happened in one council in any year in the past. And I think that shows that this actually works and has been demonstrated to work in the past.
Could I have one final question? Rural areas, in particular, some specialities are finding it difficult to recruit. Will those councils be penalised if they're unable to recruit the appropriate number of teachers?
No.
Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The final question from Mr. Mara, please.
Thank you. It's regarding the exceptional circumstances you laid out to Ruth Maguire for the Challenge Authorities, where you've cut the funding for the poorest communities. So Dundee sets its budget tomorrow. Has there been an application for exceptional circumstances from Dundee, or frankly from any of the other Challenge Authorities?
Local authority?
Well, for a start, we have not cut the funding for poorest communities. What we have done, as agreed with COSLA, is we've actually looked at where the poorest communities and the poorest children are, and we have put the funding to those, and yes, that is across 32 local authorities. The exceptional circumstances would obviously take place once we are in year and once we're looking at changes either up or obviously down to the teacher numbers, and the councils coming forward and suggesting that there are exceptional circumstances for that. So No council would be coming forward with this because they're setting their budget at that point. It would be inappropriate for a council to do that just now. That's what the discussions are for in year, as I've just went through with Mr Rennie, about dealing with any changes, variations to the number of teacher numbers, and it's for at that point for us to talk about exceptional circumstances.
I think it's useful to have clarity on that mechanism that is in year prior to the budget being set. For clarity, Dundee's budget, and this has been cut by £4.9 million for the poorest community in the country.
Thank you very much, and I'd like to thank you for your time today. We are now going to have a suspension of around 5 minutes to allow a change of witnesses. Thank you. Thank you. Welcome back, everyone. Our next item on our agenda this morning is an evidence session on the Disabled Children and Young People Transitions to Adulthood Scotland Bill. And we have two panels of witnesses joining us today. But can I welcome our first panel? We have Tracy Francis, Scott Richardson-Reed and Rebecca Williams, who are all policy and development workers from the Scottish Transitions Forum ARC Scotland. We have a lot of ground to cover today, and so we will move straight to members' questions. And the first questions are from Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Thanks for being with us. I've been asking witnesses previously what they think the key barriers are to a good transition for our disabled children and young people. So I'd like to open up with that question to all of the panel there. And I wonder if you can, when reflecting back on that, give me your views on where good practice does happen, what it is you think is driving that. And if I can come to Tracy first, please.
Yes, thank you. I think one of the problems is that transitions is so complex. And I think when young people are moving from children to adulthood, it's not just around finishing school and finding the next step. It's around a social life. It's around healthcare. It could be involving social services. There are so many people who are involved. And I think it's easy to underestimate the complexity of that and how much of an impact that has on the whole life, not just for the young person, but for the families and the siblings as well. So I think a lot of the barriers are around its consistency of working. It's around joined up thinking with the services who are trying to support. There's lots of, as you say, there's lots of areas of good practice where good things are happening, but there's not enough connection between the services. Very often they're using different language. They might be using different processes. And the young person and the family who are at the centre are trying to make sense of that. And it's actually a very confusing and it can be quite a scary place to be. So I think, you know, some of the barriers that are coming into, or that we are hearing a lot about, are, you know, young people and families not having the information they need. They're not getting the communication from, the people who are supporting them, either because those people, you know, don't really, sometimes they don't have the information themselves. Sometimes it's very easy, I'm sure you'll understand, if you're in a professional role yourself and you're used to working in that environment and you forget that the person who's in front of you is going through this for the first time. So you assume that everyone knows what you know and you don't think to pass something on or you don't think to explain something as clearly as you might do. So, you know, that can cause difficulties there. There's certainly difficulties around, I guess, the person-centeredness of it. It's when, it's when you're dealing with an individual and every individual is going to have a different set of circumstances, a different level of complexity, maybe different requirements and different aspirations for their lives. So managing to get a system that's flexible enough to work with all the individuals that come through that process, I think can be quite a challenge.
Thank you. And can I just ask, that flexibility that you're talking about, is that about culture? Is that about resource, capacity? What makes for a good person-centred, flexible service?
I think it's a little bit of everything, actually, to be honest. I think sometimes, as I say, there's the thinking around, what needs to happen and having the conversations. I think sometimes it's being open to working, and this is speaking from, what parents and carers and young people are telling us, it's listening to what they have to say about what they want and being flexible enough around that to just think out of the box. Maybe not necessarily being tied down by only, what someone else has experienced or only what you can see happening in your own area, but just being open to being able to be flexible to try and bring about the outcome that the young person's wanting and what their goals and ambitions are happening to be.
And sorry, I'm just focusing on you, Tracy, but if more legislation and guidance, does that assist in being more flexible?
I think actually in Scotland, I would say that we have a pretty good legislative landscape around this area at the moment. Nowhere is perfect, but I think we have a good landscape. I think that the difficulty or one of the challenges is that for a lot of local authorities particularly, but other organisations as well, don't necessarily or haven't necessarily had the practical guidance as to how to put that legislation into practice. So they have the statutory duties, they have that framework they're meant to be working with, but what does that translate to on the front line? And I think that's where we refer to it as the implementation gap sometimes. We've got the legislation there, but it's not actually making it through to the families who need to have that service. So, I think that providing a little bit, this is one of the things, I know my colleague Beck is going to talk about this in a moment, but the principles into practice framework that we've been developing through ARC Scotland, which you've had communications about that, a lot of that was very much geared towards providing some of that practical support and guidance to put these things into practice, because we know what works. It just means that we actually have to translate that into, how you do that. How do you change those teams? What people do you need to have in place to be able to make that happen?
Thank you. That's helpful. Happy to hear from any other members of the panel if they have anything to add.
Can I just come in on some of the things that Tracy's talked about? We, as you said, Tracy, we know where the barriers are. We know where the problems are. We probably know what the solutions are too. Why transitions are complex is also a bit of a meta issue as well, and it's probably useful to define what we talk about when we talk about transition. And a lot of people seem to think that transitions is simply a step into education and employment and training, but for the young people and the families that we work with, transitions is a whole life change in everything, not just kind of going to college and getting a job, but it's a change in benefits, a change in human rights. It's a change in how siblings might relate to the young person. It's a change in how the family might have to quit their job to support their young person because there's no support for them to step into. So when I talk about transitions, I'm talking about that like moving into young adulthood. And as Tracy said, we have a really robust but complicated legislative framework that sits around that. And that is a framework that we created. It's not like... We created the transitions framework to support people, and it's got more and more complicated. And there is different legislation sitting on top of different legislation. And to come in on the point that Tracy was talking about in terms of the communication, you could even argue that transitions is an education for professionals issue too, because my background is a social worker. I'm also a trained psychologist. I've also worked in schools. I've also been a support worker for young people with complex and challenging behaviour. I didn't ever know what other people knew. Sorry, that might sound a bit weird, but like I was trained to be a social worker, so I knew my social worker roles, right? I never really knew what teachers had to do when it came to helping young people move on. So I could only be singly accountable for my element as a social worker. I didn't know what the accountability were for teachers or healthcare professionals or OT or allied health professionals and how that all tied into careers and benefits and housing and transport. So when we look at transitions in a more of a wider meta definition of stepping into young adult life, you suddenly see why it gets really complicated, because there's all these different professionals that come together for a meeting and nobody really knows necessarily what other people should be doing. So one of those solutions and the barriers, I think, definitely are that kind of joined up training and that joined up approach, potentially starting pre-graduation in terms of kind of getting transitions on the map and the radar. And that's some of the work that we do with Napier University, actually, with student nurses. And you would have met the DIs previously, and a lot of those go in and speak to the young student nurses about their experience and how they had to become the key driver, along with parents, of holding all of that information. So another barrier, I think, in terms of transitions is professionalizing parents. So you suddenly have to be like, you have to know all the things, right? You have to know all the stuff. It's not their job. Like, it's their job to be parents in this kind of situation. So one of the issues that can happen is parents get flustered and burnt out and don't get the support that they need. So a solution to transition is bringing that all together and helping people understand the whole picture that sits around in the legislative framework. And it is robust. And it does on paper do the job that it should potentially be doing. So the question for us is, does adding more legislation to that legislation salad solve a problem in the round? Sorry, is legislation salad okay to say it? I don't know.
It's the least tasty salad ever. Yep.
Very tasty. But Beck, I'll offer that to you to speak to you too.
I think the just further to what Scott and Tracy have said, I think one of the things that makes it tricky, just like Scott said, you know, as a professional in a particular role, you know what you're meant to be doing most of the time. Actually, not all the time, because transition is often just a tiny bit of someone's job. There's not many people in the country where it's their complete focus. So actually, we do find that sometimes people don't know what their role is in terms of transition, and we do a lot of work trying to make sure people understand what their role is and then are able to carry that out. But if you know what you're meant to be doing, the timeline for transitions that's set out quite clearly in the Additional Support for Learning Act, for example, has a clear timeline of when things should be happening, and then there's other bits of legislation that's set on top. But if one person isn't able to do what they're meant to be doing at a certain point of time, there's a knock-on effect for the others being able to do their statutory duties or best practice. We have done for a number of years, run training for people across all sectors and parents and carers to come together to really unpick this. And, you know, that can be really quite challenging dynamics in the room, because there's a lot of emotion when it comes to transition, because when it goes badly, people know it's awful for all involved. So there's often heightened anxiety. But when we start unpicking, okay, why isn't it working? And we say, well, you know, education should be doing this at this time, but we can't do that because we're not really aware of this case. So, you know, they say, well, social work can't get involved until this point in time because we've got restricted capacity. And we just see quite clearly then the knock-on effect that happens. And this is one of the reasons we say that transition needs the planning has to begin with enough time to allow for this to all take place.
Thank you. Those are really helpful insights. And I think our experience of speaking with parents, your reflection about them having to become professionals and take all that on, certainly resonates. I know there's lots of other colleagues wanting to come in, so if I leave it there.
Stephanie Callaghan.
Yeah, just to pick up on something that you guys were talking about there as well, something we've heard in evidence quite a lot is that where there's been a transition lead, where there's been someone who has been working with families all the way through, they've built those long-term relationships, they've built up trust, that actually that has been the thing that has made the difference really to the family, and they've been able to reach out into all those other organisations and really pull everything together. So I suppose what I'm wondering as well is, you know, certainly you're welcome to comment on that, and I'm wondering as well, does the bill take us any further forward? Does it provide the potential to resolve any of this bit?
I think, to be honest, yes, you know, the role of something like a transitions coordinator or a designated person that can be a point of contact actually is incredibly valuable. And I think going back to professionalising parents and so on, you know, people, when you're starting this process, people don't know what they don't know. So they don't know what questions to ask. And if you're talking to a range of professionals who are each saying something slightly different, it's very difficult to bring that together. So having one point of contact that you can turn to, I think, is hugely reassuring. But it's also making it's that kind of commitment that makes, you know, transitions is important. We're going to invest in this. We're going to make this a role that it's somebody's responsibility to be on top of the information that is shared to parents and how that's and young people and how that's done. So, you know, yes, certainly where we've seen that kind of commitment made, and again, this is something that has been trialled through Principles into Practice. There's one local authority area that's trialling having a designated person, and it has actually made a huge difference to the parents who are going through that process now. You know, they will talk very passionately about how valuable that's been for them. I think one of the key things around having the designated person is who that happens to be. And it has to be somebody, I think, that the young people and the parents and carers feel they can build that relationship of trust with. I think, you know, we've seen in the past, in another context with named person and so on, you know, if it's somebody that the young people and the parents and carers don't have confidence in and don't particularly feel, you know, it's maybe encroaching on their family life or their responsibilities or whatever it happens to be, then it can be counterproductive. So I don't know, Scott, if you want to say anything about what the bill has to say, the transitions bill has to say about this.
Yeah, I kind of want to come in on your point as well about a key person. Mm-hmm. And for me and the young people that I work with and the parents I talk about, it's about aspirational stuff. It's not necessarily like you go to the job centre every Tuesday and do a thing in terms, and I'm kind of talking about the planning element in the bill here, and it kind of links to that key person in terms of, for me, who does the planning and what does the plan look like, and can you legislate for a relationship, really? And I very much have a thrust that the work that we do must be relational, and it must be, when I say person-centred, that sounds like a jargon word, but it means that you've got to at least get on with the person, and they've got to be in the middle of what you're talking about. So where there hasn't been a key person, and there's examples that we can kind of give post this, if that would be useful, the key person has kind of arisen out of need, and that sounds very dramatic, but it could be, for instance, a person in the church is one example that I know, or a teacher that goes the extra mile, that pulls it all together through personal experience, or a particular social worker or a kind of support worker who's got a really good relationship with somebody. And it's that pedagogical, I can't say that word, for the pedagogy. Yeah, you know what I'm saying. Hopefully you'll spell that right in a minute. Of that young person and the family that helps that relationship move forward. So you can probably legislate for somebody to be in that role, but the values that they come into that role with can't necessarily be legislated for. So it would be a employment focused thing. Is this the right kind of person to fill a role that can sit as a coordinator in families? And they will have a particularly key role to play in the planning. And in the transitions bill that we're talking about, is the planning is really problematic for me in the way that it's written in the bill, because it doesn't make any sense, really, to me, how that's going to work. Who does the plan? Who's the plan for? What's the plan about? Is it, if we go back to that definition of transitions being a whole life change, and I'm like a social worker who's yours and I'm limited by resources, time, we all know the kind of situation that's happening in social care at the moment. My plan might be that you go to the job centre every Tuesday and I have met the legislative requirement of that plan, right? First is, I've sat down and worked with Scott, we'll use me as an example, for 6 months, and I know that Scott wants to be a surgeon down the line, not that I do, but what does that mean then in terms of planning? And what that to me is kind of really good planning. And we have such brilliant examples in Scotland already of really good planning, like the big plan that if you've heard from Thistle, and also you would have heard some of that from Kieran, one of the young people that I work with, talking about this effective planning. Also through the ILF fund, there is a grant for £500 to allow really good person-centred planning to be happening. But we're going back to that issue of what Tracy says, people don't know what they don't know. So they don't necessarily know to access that or why they need planning, because they think actually transitions is maybe fully supported. So we go back to the key person again being really key. Sorry, that was a bit...
Can I just check as well then? So am I getting this clear then? Is the issue that actually what matters to the individual needs to be central to that plan, and that's missing?
Yeah.
Sorry. Okay,
and it's like, how do you legislate that into legislation when we have similar issues with plans around the child, where the young person should be included, but it becomes a very statutory framework, and the young person's voice and aspirations come at the bottom of that list of concerns, I guess. Sorry, I've taken up a lot of airspace.
On that, I know Michael wants to come in on that thread there, Scott, if you don't mind. And Michael Mara, sorry, let me.
Yeah, I appreciate that. And it's really useful, Scott. I suppose I'm worried a little bit about, you're talking about essentially the quality of the plans. There could be a plan that's poor, but you would recognise at the moment that many, many young people just don't have plans. And the current approach in that regard hasn't really worked. So would it not be a step forward to insist that those plans, and then we can work on quality, you know, after that event? Is that not?
Yes and no. I would like to personally, and this is as representing SDF, but personally as me, to see the legislation recommend the kind of planning that should happen in the legislation, not just a plan, and just to kind of reflect on a plan could be you go to the job centre every Tuesday, or a plan could be you will work with somebody to help you achieve your aspirations, whatever they are. So I would like to see that in the legislation, because what will happen is we'll go, and I'm cynical, but we'll go to the lowest common denominator of what planning is due to resource restrictions. And I don't necessarily mean budgets, but I also mean staffing time, resources, and that kind of more general sense.
Tracy, do you want to come in?
Yes, if you wouldn't mind. It's just to make a point that what we don't want to do is have a plan to be something that's done to a family or done to a young person. I think, you know, what the key for me is not necessarily who is responsible for the plan. As you were saying, Scott, it could be somebody in the church that you trust. It could be somebody in, it could be a trusted teacher, whoever. But it's got to be led by the young people and by the parents and carers. And I think, you know, so often, and I'm speaking here as a parent of a young woman who's got autism herself, and she's in her 20s now, so I've kind of been through this as a parent. And sometimes, you know, I've been in a situation where the person who has been allocated to work with me around something is somebody we don't know. There's a group of people that is supportive for us, and then we're actually having to include somebody else into this process that we don't know, that's coming in from the outside. And maybe it's somebody, that doesn't mean to say that they're a bad person or they don't know their stuff, but, you know, it's kind of going, well, who are you? You know, why are you here? And I think that's one of the things that can cause planning sometimes to feel a little bit distance. It's arm's length. It's not actually connecting with your real life, because it's involving people that you've been allocated rather than people that you've been chosen. So I think that's something that I would like to see addressed if we can.
It's coming as well.
Just one quick point about the key point of contact. We talked about totally, you know, agree with Scott around it has to be the person with the right values, but also I think, and I'm thinking about the area in particular that we know have been trialling this really successfully, it's also about the that role. I believe the person in that role has done such a fantastic job for a lot of reasons, one of which the link she has to the different teams involved, so the social work teams, children and adult teams as well, and with the schools. So those relationships are really strong, and we know that to support the planning, support the young person moving through that, someone who's in that position is really key. We also know, and it became quite obvious and probably could have guessed it in that area, that one person is not enough, and that person is working well over when they, you know, the amount they should be. There needs actually a team, and a team with those strong links. And that also not just provides a go-to person for the young person and their family, it provides a go-to person for people working in other teams, other sectors around involved in the care of young people, to be able to form that relationship with as well, which is just as important.
That's certainly something we recognise in what we've heard so far, Rebecca, I would say, for sure. Stephen Kerr, do you have a supplementary?
Scott's contribution so far has been very interesting, especially when we refer to the legislation salad you were describing. So when you talk about the plan, am I picking up that you don't think this is something that can be legislated for? Or is it just that, as the bill's presented, you want it to be more prescriptive? Because, in the same vein, I mean, you rightly say, I think it's probably the question of the morning, can you legislate a relationship? And of course you can't. So, your thoughts?
Can the legislation? Yeah, I think you can legislate for a robust methodology of planning. So you can put that into legislation, and we know that there are ways of planning that are evidenced to be really good, and young people and parents and carers tell us what these are. So you could potentially put that into legislation, and I think at the moment how the legislation as presented, as written in law, and I'm not talking about the rhetoric that comes with the guidance and stuff, but as written in law, which would be challenged, is not. Is it more than we already have? It's just kind of like somebody by the age of 16 should have a written down transitions plan. That kind of already happens in school through the Additional Support for Learning Act. They should have a transition, should have a transitions plan by that age. Will this legislation saying the same thing, you should have a transitions plan by that age, make any difference if they already should have a transitions plan with an additional support need under the Additional Support for Learning Act and all of those processes? So I also am not naive to just because something is law doesn't make it actually happen on the ground. It can take a lot of time. So looking at the bill as stands, I don't think it's strong enough in terms of the planning element. If I was to look at that, I would want to legislate for the kind of enhanced planning that young people with additional support needs would need, would be this person-centred big plan, maps and paths, really effective planning.
I think a holistic approach to what legislation can and can't do, is it an area that should be legislated on?
Can I interject? We are about to move into a section on that sort of legislative element, Mr. Kerr. I was just curious that we've got other members that were going to lead the questioning on that.
It just seems logical to ask it.
Well, carry on. And then I'll talk with you later.
I think, knowing the legislation that I do and knowing how people struggle to get things met in the legislation, I guess it's a bigger question. Does law make a difference to practice? Yes, it does, but actually the system doesn't necessarily change very fast because there's a law. You have to embed the training and the change of culture into all of that. So by putting that into legislation, does it allow that culture change to start to move through? Maybe. It's going to be my answer to that. But we know, working with the legislation that we already do across health, like the NICE guidelines that sit and the additional support for learning and all of that stuff, that actually new people coming on the ground need retrained in that and what that means. So it's going to be an ongoing challenge, I think, if that makes sense. Sorry.
Thank you. That's no problems at all, Scott. I'm going to move over to some questions to kickstart the discussion around the legislation from the Vice Convener, CoCab Stewart. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. You might find that some of the areas have already been touched on by my colleagues. However, I just want to drill down a little bit further. So I suppose what I'm interested in is that ultimately, will this bill, this legislation, be required to create better outcomes? Do you feel that this bill would actually have the impact that it's trying to achieve? Or do we already, well, you've already mentioned a load of good practice that's required. You've mentioned relationships. I was also thinking, can you legislate for cultural change and good leadership? Because that is also part of having good transitions and supporting our young children. So, yeah.
I'll start and then...
Thank you, Scott.
You can get in and you can say something and you can come in. Does the legislation... There's been two versions of this legislation in my head. The first version, which was then tidied up into the second version. So the first version, I would actually say absolutely not. The second version, why it's changed is the idea of the definition of disability under the Equality Act that the bill brings in, which I think is a really, really important consideration. So we're not just talking about disabled people, we're talking about anybody with a moderate and severe enduring condition, because it's the Equality Act definition. I think I've got that right. If I haven't, tell me. So that opens up the demographic to a lot of young people, potentially, in Scotland. So I'm pulling figures out of my head, 37% of young people in Scotland at the moment have an additional support need. Potentially in some local authorities, that's something like 43%. So we're almost like one in one, roundabout, one in two, one in three young people. So this bill might impact them in terms of transitions planning. So if it doesn't, they can then potentially have a case of like, I'm going to have to prove that I'm disabled enough to get the support that I need so this bill can help me under the Equality Act definition, which is a huge shift. Because when young people are in school, they have an additional support need. When they're adults, they have disabled because there's a transition. The language suddenly changes and they go through diagnostic processes to access services and all of this kind of stuff. So that's kind of within this bill. Another question is, how does it align with existing legislation? There's nothing in this bill that talks about the Additional Support for Learning Act or the tribunal structure. There's nothing in this bill that talks about what happens if this doesn't happen. Who do I go and complain to? Like, I have a right to live the life I want. It's like a rights-based bill in my mind, and there's no kind of consideration of that rights-based approach in the bill, really. And if my rights aren't being met, who do I go to under this piece of legislation? Like, where's the complaints, basically? If you don't have accountability in legislation, is there a point in having the legislation if it's not accountable? The planning stuff we've already touched on, which I think is the meat and potatoes of this bill. And I should say, I really, really agree with the aims and objectives of the bill, and I can totally see where they're coming from. I'm just really concerned that by introducing more legislation into the legislation salad, which is the word of the morning, we're going to have a more complex situation, and then there'll be people using this as an avenue to get support, and the other avenues of support won't be as funded or won't be as focused on. So, like, also, how do we identify what the extra entitlements of this bill will be? We already have, if we think of a spectrum of young people, and this sounds awful, but on the spectrum of young people with additional support needs, you have the people that will have more complex needs and the people that you kind of know are going to be all right. But then there's all of the young people in the middle that are just missed by the legislation that we have at the moment. And this bill potentially does a similar thing, because I think it was originally drafted with a focus on learning disability only, which is a very strict diagnostic, IQ under 70, all of that kind of stuff. And this has expanded the definition, which I think is the right thing to do, and I'm not anti that at all, but that opens it up to like mental health and autism, and the numbers and the financial memorandum don't really reflect the amount of young people. So if we're like 120,000, we know that 20% of those are known to like social work. It's not many. I'm not doing the maths in my head. But if you go through the CMIS list of the different conditions, you can probably say about, I don't know, 2/3 to 3/4 of those young people would potentially fall under the premise of this bill, which is roughly, what, 75,000, 80,000? In 1 year, so if it's 80,000 in 1 year, and you're talking from age 16 to 26, that's 800,000 young people that would be suddenly fall under the premise of this bill if it was enacted, that would need transitions plans and support. Don't shoot me with the numbers, but...
We won't, that's quite a large number. I don't know if anyone else wants to come in and contribute that question from COCAP.
Not on the numbers, I don't want to add to that. Just to say, I guess, so if we get say we got the planning right, we need to also be, obviously that has to be properly resourced so people can achieve what they want to and what's in their planning. But we need to also be looking at, you know, how do we increase the opportunities for young people beyond beyond education, out in the world, in the communities, you know, has to be happening at the same time, because we could end up with all these fantastic shiny new plans, but they're not able to be acted upon. And that could be potentially even more devastating for families, that built up expectation, you know, really being listened to of what you want in your life and really being imagining that. And that's hard for a lot of young people. And then for it not to come about could be quite devastating.
Tracy?
Yeah, I think also, you know, for me, within the bill, it assumes that if a young person is under the age of 16, that it's education who are going to be responsible for the plan and taking the plan forward. But as we said, you know, transition, we take it up to 25, 26 if someone is care experienced. The question for me is, who is responsible then for that plan if this bill goes through for those young people who have already left education and, you know, maybe are further down the line? There's the question there about, I think the assumption is social work, but we know that in practice, very many families are really, really struggling to have be allocated a social worker because, you know, the resources there are not as good as they should be at the moment. And I think, you know, there's a whole question there of, well, who is responsible for that planning? And supposing a plan is put together while someone is in education, but, you know, 2 years down the line, they've done their college course or they've gone on to whatever it is, but then they've changed their mind or that's not worked out or circumstances have changed. Who then takes that plan and adjusts it and makes it relevant to their situation at that point? You know, because the plan is not something that's set in stone. It's something that we talked about flexibility earlier. It's something that should be flexible enough to follow that young person through whatever life throws at them during that period of time. So I'm not sure. I remain to be convinced that the bill actually speaks to that as strongly as I would like to see it do.
Yeah, I think you've given some great examples there and talked us through it. I'm sensing that there is no overwhelming feeling from you that this legislation would actually guarantee any better outcomes. So that is quite clear there. I think which aspects of the bill, as it is at the moment that's in front of you, would you change?
I think, to be honest, for me, that would be one. It would be, you know, what happens after someone is out of formal education? Who is the person that they would go to if things start falling apart, if that plan needs to be changed, if, you know, and at the moment, it tends to be the parents and carers and families who pick that up and carry that forward. And we said again earlier about professionalising parents. You know, that's something, it's not a fair responsibility to put on to parents that have got other responsibilities and so on at that stage in their lives. So that, for me, would be the bit that, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Anyone else wanted to, what one bit would you change? You don't need to if you...
I can't say planning because that's already been done.
if you don't need to.
I guess fine. Just... greater clarity in terms of who would be responsible for the planning. I'm not going to go into the details of the planning. But also, you know, I mean, the financial memorandum, a really robust look at the figures and ensuring that the planning gets enough time. I think it's 4 hours that's written into the bill, which we know for young people to even engage in the process, that's nowhere near what's needed. So just a more thorough look at that and how it interlinks with the other pieces of legislation that are already there and the other plans that are already within those bits of legislation.
Ian first.
I've got loads to add all the time. The bill is... on the surface is trying to make sure people have the life that they want, right? And I totally appreciate that, but life is more complex and legislation doesn't just make that happen. One of the things I would like to see the bill address, and it doesn't do that, is how it's going to deal with the stigma in the workplace for young people that are coming through. So you can make the best plan in the world, but if the company, organisation, holiday resort isn't accessible or don't know anything about disability or additional support needs, the plan isn't going to happen anyway, because there'll just be no jobs or there'll be no access or there'll be discrimination. And it's kind of like the best planning in the world doesn't remove the barriers of discrimination that young people with additional support needs, disabilities and autism face on a daily basis. So.
Mr. Day, if it's a short supplementary before I come to Ross Greer,
thank
short,
I appreciate
please.
It, Convener. So we've talked about the bill and how it could be improved, but imagine the bill wasn't there. And in a short time, we've got two government ministers in front of us. If you were sitting with them, what would you say to them is needed to improve the experience of these young people in transition, and how would they go about it as briefly as possible?
I think a lot of the things that we've actually touched on, to be honest. I think it's Scott mentioned the training, sort of joined up training across services and across professionals. We've talked about having that designated, you know, sort of coordinating role that doesn't have to be in the role of a named person, but it is somebody holding that together. The communication and the information to everybody involved, the professionals, the parents and carers, the young people. I think that's one of the other things that I think I would actually like to mention is around use of data and evaluation of what works and how we track improvements and how we look at what's making a difference, what's not, and adjust practice accordingly so that it's actually evidence-based. Because I think at the moment there isn't really... and we can talk about this a little bit about the tool that we've been developing through Arts Scotland with Compass that's going to produce some of that evidence. But we don't have an evidence base. We have anecdotal evidence around what people's experiences are. So it makes it very difficult then to make an argument for shift and for change that we know is going to be effective. So I think, you know, there's something there about trying to get... a better and a bigger picture, you know, the full picture of what transitions is like in Scotland at the moment. And I think that's our baseline. That's where we should really start. And so, you know, perhaps rather than rushing to more legislation, establishing that baseline, finding out, you know, what the facts are, what can we evidence, what are people actually experiencing, then giving time to some of, you know, embed some of the things that we've been talking about around good practice, around training, and then, you know, maybe if that doesn't work, if that doesn't, you know, that then still we're not seeing improvements, sure, maybe we need to revisit legislation, have a look at that and say, well, is it fit for purpose? But give those things time to embed first.
Good, thank you.
And just for clarification, the first version of the bill did reference the Equality Act, so just make sure. But that's fine. Can I now move to questions from Ross Greer, please?
Thanks, Convener. I thought that was a really, really useful answer from Tracy, so I just wanted to see if Scott and Rebecca had any thoughts on that. And without wanting to put words in your mouth, Tracy, and just cut me off if this is an unfair representation, I think you were essentially saying that there are other things that we could prioritise first, and if they don't work, then perhaps a legislative approach similar to this bill would be appropriate, but we should prioritise those non-legislative approaches first. Scott and Rebecca, would that be your view, or would you like to see legislation at this point?
I would agree with Tracy. That's probably no surprise. that there's a lot that we're focusing on currently, but that will be, you know, it's not a quick fix. If there was a quick fix for transitions, we would have fixed it. But that's going to take long. I guess with our focus, there's always this kind of tension between, you know, knowing that's what needed is long-term systemic change and these things are going to take time, but also knowing that young people are still going to transition at the rate they currently are. They're not going to wait for us to get it right for them. So this isn't quite what you were asking, but if I had a magic wand, I would say, yes, let's keep investing and follow through with the approaches that we've got to really embed the current, the full extent of the current policy that we have. Framework. But at the same time, I'd say that, you know, if I could, I'd say that every young person and family who are approaching transition and going through transition would have that single point of contact, someone that they can that can support them through this, if I was, you know, given that power.
Again, I think it's the systemic change versus fast things, that things need to happen now to support young people. And again, it's that people need a coordinator, they need a place to go, they need the information, they need the support that they're entitled to. Families and carers need support. All of this stuff has to happen, but then versus the systemic change. I live in a bit of a dream world where I would like to see legislation like this actually co-produced by the people that are actually impacted by it. So starting with the young people and the parents and carers and moving into the local authorities to actually get their view on what would be the best way to support the people who are in it to do it, having tried all the other bits and pieces, that like there are mechanisms potentially that would be useful, such as changing the adult social care criteria to allow adult social work to step in earlier. Those kind of things, minor changes, would be interesting conversations to have, I think, and that's how I would like to see this legislation be developed, in terms of that really on the ground upswell, rather than a kind of, yeah, as it has been produced at the moment.
Thanks very much. On that last point then, Scott, just to be clear, would you prefer if, rather than Parliament proceeding with the legislation in its current form right now, are you suggesting that maybe a little bit more time is taken to do that co-development work with those who are directly experiencing this, and then perhaps come back to us with this bill or something similar to it at a later point, with a bit more work having been done?
Yeah, I would probably... There's two parts of the bill we haven't discussed, which is the minister in charge of transitions, which personally I think that's a massive manifesto. If we go into that, the definition of transition not being just education employment, they would actually have to hold everything that the Scottish Parliament do. But also the strategy, I think, that the bill mentions, and I know that there's a strategy underway which the bill doesn't mention, would potentially lead down that route, actually, Ross. So, yeah.
Thanks very much. And just one more question from myself. That part of the premise of the bill is that we'll improve transitions if we compel public bodies to take on these duties. So the compulsion is that core premise there. I think we can all understand the thinking behind that, that if we simply mandate this, then it should therefore happen, and that will resolve some of the inconsistencies, because there are some good experiences of transitions out there. But the comparator there is coordinated support plans. They are the one statutory plan that exists in this broad space at the moment. There's two problems with them. One is that almost no children, young people with additional support need to have them. And the second is that for a lot of those that do, that still isn't actually resulting in what's in the plan being delivered. So I'd be interested in your thoughts on that. The question of is compulsion for public bodies the solution here, bearing in mind our experience with CSPs, or is the problem with CSPs not really related to that, it's something else?
I'll come in really briefly, Ross. CSPs were replaced a bit by the Child's Plan through the Children and Young People Act, so there was a bit of a conflation in practice, I think, that we don't need a CSP anymore because we have a Child's Plan. Actually, no, you need both, but they both said similar things. So people were a bit confused in terms of practice. Well, it has happened when people have had a complaint. It has gone to a commission, and the commission has taken so long to deal with the complaint, the young person has transitioned out of school already, and it's actually a kind of retrospective, you shouldn't have done that, but actually my life is no better than it was after I made the complaint. So we do a lot of work with people about realising early on if you're not getting the support that you need and what you're entitled to as a parent, young person. I have a feeling this will be similar in terms of what happens with that if you don't get a plan. There's no mention, as I've already said, in the bill about the accountability for that. Like, where does the accountability sit and how does it sit alongside a coordinated support plan, an IEP or a child's plan and all the other plans that people have. One of the things that we are eager to see is for young people to just have one plan that involves all of the other plans, that is plans around the plans, if that makes sense, to streamline all of that. And again, that's like a huge systemic issue, and we could go into that for hours, I think. But yeah, so is compulsion the right way? Does giving somebody a route to complain? It works sometimes, but what's the outcome? Like, if I complain, do I get what's in my plan? Or is it like a litigative year and a half struggle that will be settled outside because we don't want to set case law on this to set a precedent, but then I'll get what I want because I wrote to my MSP? You probably all get written to about this stuff often. And then, you know, is that the process that people have to go through? And does that just end up really exacerating the problem? I don't know.
I think there are also issues around eligibility as well, because, you know, we know that there's quite long waiting lists to get diagnoses these days for certain conditions or certain disabilities. You know, some of them are very evident and obvious, but others of them are not so obvious. So, you know, I'm hearing more and more from your parents and carers who are being told that their children are not eligible for a formal planning process because they don't meet those criteria. And yet it's evident that those children still need support and are still very vulnerable and possibly are not going to make a smooth transition, that it's going to be a bumpy ride for them. But because they don't fit the neat little box, then they're not getting the support, even basic support, around things like signposting to services and so on. So I think, you know, there's an issue there as well, about people actually just struggling to, whenever you make something compulsory, you have to draw, you know, sort of boundaries as to who's in and who's out, and how many people are going to be struggling to get in who really still, you know, definitely need some form of support and planning.
Thank you. I need to move on now to questions from Michael Marrow, please.
Thank you, Convener. So you said that, I think it might have been Scott who said that we should prioritise non-legislative approaches first. How long would you give that?
Very good question. I think there are fast things that you can do in terms of, and I think this is a kind of principles into practice question with the trials that we've been running in terms of Compass and the data and how that kind of comes through. So there are quick wins that you can do that mean that people get the information and support that they want, which Beck can speak to more on. But then there are long systemic changes. How long does it take to change a culture? Like, let's look at the rollout of self-directed support or the Children and Young People's Act or the UNCRC. How long is it taking to embed with that? And there's the implementation gap that Tracy was talking about. So how long's a piece of string, Michael? I couldn't really say.
I suppose what I may take answers to that question from colleagues as well, but I suppose what I'm trying to reflect is the frustration that, you know, we're talking about, I mean, Ross is talking about CSPs, we're looking about 1% of people with ASN have these plans. The evidence we've taken for families tells us that this is, you know, an awful situation for an awful lot of people. So we're not just talking about small tweaks, you know. And so what can we do to drive that change? Because at the moment it doesn't feel like it's happening.
About what we've been doing for the last 2 years and the kind of progress we've made today in terms of principles into practice. I know you've got communications about this. So principles into practice is that a national framework that we've developed that supports the practical implementation of those seven principles of good transition. And also, crucially, as Tracy mentioned, it gives local authority areas the tools and the means to kind of assess how well they're implementing each of those principles and each part of those principles as well, so that they can ensure that the improvements they're making are based on the lived experience of people in their area, not just what they think they're doing well. You know, we've got a shiny new policy, that's fine, tick. It's actually like, is it working on the ground? So we've been working over the last 2 years with 10 local authority areas across the country, two of which have been what we call our enhanced trial areas, Falkirk and Dundee, and we've been working with them quite intensively, I guess, over the last 2 years. And then we've got eight other, what we're calling universal trial areas, who are largely independently trialling the framework with support from ourselves. All 10 areas are making progress. That progress looks different. The pace of change looks different across every area. There's been, I don't need to tell you what's happened in the last 2 years, there's been major changes that have had massive impacts on this work. However, all 10 areas are still positively engaged with us and, as I said, making progress. We're coming to the end of the two-year trial program, end of next month, end of March. So at the moment, we're working really hard with the areas to reflect back and gather what we're calling spotlight examples, so examples of good practice, think back of what they've learnt, and how we capture that and share it across the country.
So a timeline, at what point would you be able to assess whether this work has worked or not?
Well, some of the changes we can see right now, but we are looking for like long-term systemic change. I think the problem is a lot of time transitions, because it is such a hot issue, it attracts project funding, because it's a big issue, we need to do something, and there's loads of good project work happening, but then the project funding comes to an end, it's not embedded within the system, and then a lot of that progress is lost.
My frustration in this is that you're describing a chronic situation and you're describing short-term actions and you're telling us perhaps that this legislation doesn't deal with that. But what the Parliament is trying to do is try and find a mechanism to accelerate that and make it work. And at the moment, it doesn't seem to be happening. So I'm not being offered a kind of a time frame in which you as professionals would make a judgment as to whether the current approaches that you're putting in place work. Would 18 months, would that tell you whether we were on a path? Would 6 months? These are pilot programmes, you know.
Let the panel respond. Thank you.
So I guess this has never been done before. You know, this is the first time this has happened, that areas have had this kind of guidance that pulls together everything that everyone must be doing and provides them all the way forward. We're at the point now, we're at this critical point, we start to see really good changes, good practice happening, and we can give you some of those examples if you like. And I think if we stop now, we're going to risk, and the areas have no intention of stopping beyond the trial, they're going to continue, we're going to risk going backwards. I think, you know, within some of the areas have asked for an extra year, an extra 2 years, and we're saying, well, you need to continue the work, you know, we'll still be there in the background because of the delays that COVID in particular put on the program. I think, you know, in the next year, 2 years, particularly with the uptake of Compass, that will give us that really rich data from young people, from parents and carers, we're going to have a much better idea of the state of play of transitions and what is working and how we can then improve on that.
And I think with Compass, you know, that's going to be, it's been trialled during these 2 years. The national launch of Compass is scheduled for April. So at the moment, it's obviously relatively small users for the trial, but once it goes across Scotland as a whole, it will be available to all young people and to parents and carers. So we are hoping that the sign up from that and the numbers that are coming through within the next 6 to 12 months, you know, will actually increase substantially. And that means that then we're starting to collect evidence from people as to what their actual experience is. So whereas at the moment, a lot of the spotlight examples are around, you know, the changes that local authorities have made, some of the restructuring, some of the trials and things like that. But in terms of the actual impact on people's lives, I would say with probably a year, as Beck says, a year to 2 years, we will have a lot more information around that to be able to say whether this is really making a substantial difference or not.
There's a lot of content we're hearing from you, and I know I've got a list of supplementary things I'd like to ask, but we're not going to have time. The very last questions that we're going to have today is from my colleague, Mr. Bob Dorris.
Yeah, hopefully just the one question, convener. Really fascinating. During the discussion, we seem to be talking about whether we need a mechanism to make sure young people are already entitled to a good quality transition, get the transitions they're already entitled to, or, as I think Scott suggested within this bill, opening the door to a much wider, broader range of young people who currently maybe don't have that entitlement. And that tension between those who are already entitled and not getting it and those who will become entitled. So if this bill was to pass, would we need quite clear guidance that local authority and other bodies would have to prioritise based on the resources available? In other words, might this be an entitlement on paper but never realised in practice unless there's a massive, substantial increase in resource?
Yes, is the answer to that. It's the same. There's one pie, and you are potentially looking at a bill that means that more people are going to eat the pie. How do you get the pie from disappearing? You're going to have to put some kind of restriction on it. I don't know how the bill is talking to that, but it says, in as written, every young person should have a plan, and what is written in that plan they are entitled to have. Basically, that's as written in the law at the moment. I think sections 9, 11 and 13 or something, I don't know. But that's potentially, if I have a plan and it says that I should get a job in Tesco, it is the local authority's job to get me a job in Tesco. Do you know what, like, what is the, we're stuck on the idea of a plan, but what does the plan entail? If it's saying, like, I have a plan and I'm entitled to exactly what's written in that plan, I personally feel like this was written in terms of daycare service provision and not actual community provision. So I will go to a daycare community and I want to do that at 16, therefore the local authority has to provide that, versus I want to live with my girlfriend, have a family in a house near my mom and dad, have a job in the local newspaper, walk my dog. And have pals. How can you legislate? How can the local authority then be responsible for making that plan happen if it's not within their gift?
Scott, I think you've made that point really well. Rebecca and Tracy, I suppose what I'm trying to get, this may absolutely be the right thing to do, but we don't want to give people rights in principle, but the reality is they can never be exercised without substantial increase in resources that I'm not clear where they're coming from. Would that be a concern that either of you may have?
I mentioned before that transition is often just a little bit of people's jobs, and I think the resourcing issue is not just about supporting young people to achieve what they want to in their lives. Of course, that's essential, but it's also about supporting those around them to be upskilled and have the time to be able to dedicate to this planning and the support all the way through so that that experience is well supported.
I think for me, working with, we don't want to professionalise parents, we've mentioned that, but working with young people and with parents and carers is essential, because I think, you know, you could increase the resource, I don't know, 300%, and you still, there would still be need, you know, you wouldn't be able, ever be able to meet all that need. So you actually have to connect with the people who are around that young person, whether it's friends, family, community, you've got to involve them in the process and the support process as well, but not to the extent that you're actually putting professional responsibilities on them. But it's like the classic, it takes a village to raise a child. You know, you need that bigger picture. And that's something that really, I think, needs to be in there, because the resource is never going to meet the need that's going to be there.
Nikan has a specific question to you, Tracy, and I was going to give Stephanie the opportunity to ask that, looking at the clock.
It kind of touches on exactly what you said there just now, but it was just for clarity. You spoke earlier on today and you spoke about there not being or needing a coordinator when it's out with school. And earlier on, you had spoken about, actually, when we were talking about Leeds, about families having the choice. You spoke about the church, etc., there as well. So it was just to be really kind of clear on that. It's what you mean, you know, that you have someone that can come in and do a light touch and just make sure everything's going okay, a lead or a coordinator for families, or they can get more involved should the family need that further support. So it was just to get that clarity and be kind of like, I was a wee bit worried about the family choice bit, that it's like, oh yeah, you just don't need any support, and I didn't think that's what you were saying.
No. I think it's knowing what the route into services is when you need it. Because if things are going well, you don't want to have, you know, a social worker on your back telling you what to do or whatever. But there may well be times that come when you do need that level of support because circumstances have changed. So where do you go when that happens? Perfect. And I think for a lot of people, you know, who... I'm hearing from parents, if they have support through that process, they're then actually quite afraid to let go of it because they fought long and hard to get it. They don't really need it right now, but they can foresee a time in the future when they might. And they're afraid if they give it up now, they won't be able to access it again. So there's something there about, you know, ways in and out of services that reflect changing circumstances in families' lives. That's kind of, I guess, pretty much what I'm referring to.
Thank you. Yeah. As I said, it's been a really, really useful session. We've probably got lots of things that might come out. We might ask you after to respond in writing. But
the only thing I was going to say, closing, I think, was that you know, we, as you can tell, we have some reservations around the bill. But whatever happens, if the bill goes through, we will still be working with it. That's the setting that we're working in.
Thank you very much for that clarification there. As I said, we've covered a lot of ground today, so we are now going to go into suspension for about 5-10 minutes to allow for another change of witnesses for our next panel, and thank you very much for such great evidence this morning. Thank you so much. Welcome back. We will now move on to our second panel of witnesses giving evidence on the Disabled Children and Young People Transitions to Adulthood Scotland Bill. Can I welcome Claire Haughey, Minister, MSP, sorry, Minister for Children and Young People, Christina McKelvey, MSP, Minister for Equalities and Older People, Sarah Hampson, Unit Head Supporting Disabled Children and Young People, and finally Vanessa Redmond, Team Leader Supporting Disabled Children and Young People, Scottish Government. Thank you for joining us today, and we will begin with a short opening statement from the Minister for Children and Young People. Minister, over to you. You've up to 3 minutes.
Thank you, and good morning, Convener and Committee, and thank you for your invitation to Ms McKelvey and I today. I'd like to start by recognising and thanking the Member Pam Duncan-Glancy for the attention that she's drawn to the important topic of transitions for disabled young people through this bill. We know the importance of good transitions planning in preparing children and young people for life beyond school. We know, however, that for many disabled young people, the transition to young adult life still presents challenge. We also recognise that disabled young people leaving school and transitioning to young adult life is a complex area, requiring multi-agency collaboration and cooperation and a person-centred approach. We therefore wholeheartedly share the members' ambitions to improve the experience and outcomes for disabled young people as they make the transition to young adult life. However, we also share some of the questions raised by those who responded to the committee's calls for views and those who have already given evidence to the committee. And these include the potential duplication or overlap of provisions in this bill with existing policy and legislation, considerations around implementation and the proposed duties on local authorities, clarity around definitions, data sharing, eligibility and resources, and fundamentally whether the bill as drafted could have its intended impact. I therefore welcome the committee evidence sessions to consider the details of the bill's provisions. It's essential that we consider all of the evidence and options to ensure that we meet our shared aspiration of improving transitions for disabled children and young people. As I set out in the Scottish Government's response to the committee's call for views, there are already a range of legislation, plans and policies in place that support the objective of improving transitions to adulthood, and we're committed to doing more. We have already given non-statutory effect to two of the main provisions within the bill. We have done this through the Joint Ministerial Leadership for Transitions, which both Ms McKelvey and I are taking forward, and through our programme for government commitment to introducing the first national transitions to adulthood strategy for disabled young people in this parliamentary term. And there are other important developments across Scottish Government that support our shared outcomes of improving transitions for disabled children and young people. And these include refreshing the planning guidance under Getting It Right for Every Child, developing a new approach to getting it right for everyone, continued support to the ARC Scotland Principles into Practice trial, and to the Independent Living Fund Scotland's Transition Fund, continued investment in employment support, including through the Young Persons Guarantee, and important legislative developments which include the incorporation of the United Nations Convention of the Rights of the Child and the United Nations Conventions on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, and of course the National Care Service. Ms McKelvey and I would be happy to provide more details on any of these today, and I look forward to the questions that you may have.
I thank the Minister for that statement. Can we now move to members' questions and to Ruth Maguire? Just kick us off, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Ministers. Good to see you here. I've been asking this morning about and in previous sessions about panellists' reflections on what the key barriers are at the moment to achieving better outcomes for our disabled children and young people as they leave school. We've heard reflections around resources, capacity. This morning we spoke a little bit about communication and information, both kind of between practitioners and for families and the young people. Can I hear from you what you think the issues may be? And can you also talk to why there seems to be little progress in this area despite the pretty robust framework of legislation that we already have?
All right, okay. So, you know, as the committee's heard, the landscape surrounding transitions is a complex one. It's a multifaceted one. And to achieve the full potential, young disabled people may need help and support in a number of different ways and a number of different areas, and they might seek that from many different agencies. That support could include, you know, the move from school or college or transfer of a child to adult services, in addition to helping them identify and achieve employment, education, training, managing welfare, housing requirements, reviewing their healthcare needs, providing information and accurate advocacy. And so the principles of good transitions tell us there needs to be in place for young people transitioning to adult, tells us what needs to be in place for children transitioning to adulthood. But as we've heard from the previous panel members, that's not always happening on the ground for a variety of reasons. And that's why we've been supporting ARC, who were here at the previous session, to pilot and trial projects of principles into practice, to share best practice around what works, and just importantly, in order to encourage the continual improvement of what doesn't work. So I think that the strategy as we envisage will certainly assist with transitions and assist with their learning in terms of how we improve the lives of children and young people as they move through the various stages of their life. I don't know if you want to add to that.
Yeah, no, happy to add to that. A lot of the issues that Ruth Maguire raised in her question are issues that we are very recognisable to us, and it's the reason why we have taken forward the work that we are doing around about the national strategy. The evidence that the committee has heard so far echo the issues that we have as well. And you will know that we have commissioned a literature review of both UK and Scottish evidence, which we hopefully will publish soon. All of those issues are all common challenges that have emerged from that. Some of the key concerns around about stress and uncertainty for young people, particularly when leaving friends and environments, teachers, care people that they know, and that difficulty of then transferring into the adult world and the services that are available at that point as well. So we're very mindful of all of these issues. We have recognised them and we echo those concerns, and the principles of good transitions, principles into practice work, are working specifically on all of those areas in order to ensure that we make a difference when it comes to putting all of this into practice as we move forward.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Ministers. Part of the bill is asking for a Minister with specific responsibility for this cohort of our citizens. I wonder, obviously, you have, I don't know if it's joint responsibility, if that's the right term, but you both have responsibility for these children and young people. Why do you think people are calling for a specific Minister? And if that was you, what would be your priority? What do you think is the first thing that needs to be done for these children and young people?
So I think, as the committee's heard in evidence, this is not a single portfolio issue. This is a cross-government issue. It touches on all areas of health, social care, education, early years, equalities. So I think taking a joint ministerial responsibility where myself and the Minister for Equalities and Older People can work with their colleagues across government is a much more, I don't want to say sensible, because it seems like that's the more reasonable way of going forward, rather than having it sit within one particular portfolio of responsibility. If you want me to pick up on the particular issue that is raised within the bill in terms of designating a single minister as that bill is drafted, I'm happy to do that now. Or if you want to do that, okay. So I set out in my response in the call for views that we believe that there are legislative competence issues with the proposal, insofar as Scottish ministers being assigned with a special responsibility, that those powers are vested in the First Minister in sections 47(1) and 49(1) of the Scotland Act 1998.
and that could also modify the operation of Section 52(3) of that Act in breach of the restrictions in Schedule 4 of that Act. It would bring into, as the bill is drafted, it would make it, we believe, legislatively incompetent. We think that having joint ministers leading on transitions is actually a much more effective way of delivering good transitions for children and young people.
Can I just come in with a quick point as well, Convener, if you don't mind? One of the things that we get accused of often in government is sitting in more silos and not working across government when it comes to issues like this. One of the great benefits of the role I've got is I get to work right across the whole of government, and it does make sense to do this as a joint approach in taking forward these issues, because it's not the only piece of work that's ongoing to support people, particularly people with disabilities. We have an ongoing refresh right now of our Fairer Scotland for Disabled People work. We have the proposals to incorporate the UNCRPD into Scots law. So there's a number of areas here, including the review of the public sector equality duty, which basically places specific duties on local authorities and other public authorities to ensure that people's rights are respected. So there's other key pieces of work that are working alongside this to underpin the rights when it comes to a good transition. And that's why it's important that both of us are with you today.
It reflects the evidence we heard earlier on about it being a whole life change, and it's not just a transition. So can I move to some questions from Stephen Kerr, please?
Good morning, Ministers. So in the memorandum that you lodged, clearly you support the intent of the bill. I mean, I think that's a pretty universal feeling. We've heard lots of evidence about how there is a breakdown in the process through which these young people go, and how they often very badly let down. So in relation to the bill, you've raised one concern there about the designation of a minister. Are you at a point now where you can talk about other concerns you have about the provisions in the bill in relation to the fundamental question I think we all have to answer, and that is, does it an additional piece of legislation such as this improve the prospects the transitions for young people from one stage of their lives to another, will they improve? Will they have a better experience? What's your assessment?
So, do you want me to start? Okay. So, we believe that implementing the strategy that Ms. McKelvey is leading on is actually a more effective way of enabling change. We don't believe that we need legislation to do that. We believe that we're able to work alongside COSLA, as we do, on numerous strategies and local authorities and ADES to implement change and to work cooperatively to achieve the aims that we all collectively, including the member who's lodged the bill, want, and that's better transitions between school and university or college or education or whatever. So I think that working with the agencies and the representatives of the organisations like COSLA, local authorities, is a much more effective way of delivering the outcomes we want.
That's very clear. So the government's position is that you don't see this legislation as being helpful to the objective that we all share.
We absolutely support the intentions of the bill, but we had in our manifesto and as a party and also in our programme for government, we've committed to improving transitions. We've recognised that transitions do need improvement. Mm-hmm. I think we also need to recognise that, as the convener alluded to from the evidence that you'd heard earlier on, transitions are not one point in time, whereas the bill as drafted, it refers to a plan. Transitions happen through lots of different people don't leave school and then go to a destination or move from one school to college and not then move on to something else. So I think we need to be person-centred in our planning. We need to be holistic in our planning.
So well-intentioned, but ultimately not going to change much for the actual experience of
the young people who are the focus of our concern?
Well, I think it's certainly highlighted, obviously, to the committee and to wider stakeholders that certainly we need to improve transitions. But as I say, we have already committed to doing that. We would obviously, you know, look to see would the bill add value to that.
Is there any aspect of the bill, as it's been presented, that you do see has some value as legislation, as law?
I think we have a lot of questions, as I outlined in my opening statement about the bill as it's drafted currently. That's not to say that the bill could not be amended or changed.
But as it stands, there's nothing in it you think that absolutely would be a good piece of legislation. That would be very helpful to the young people concerned, or helpful to the government in focusing the efforts of the government, working with COSLA, to deliver a better experience.
I can come in on that particular point. You all have heard from Ms Hockey's opening remarks. There's two areas of the planned bill that we are currently working with. So we welcome that. We absolutely welcome the intention. We know that I think we're all on the same page on this about we want to make life better. There is already a bit of a cluttered landscape when it comes to other pieces of legislation. So, you know, if you think about, we have the Additional Support for Learning Act, we have Social Care Self Directed Support Act, as well as the Refresh Getting It Right for Every Child. You know, we have a bit of a cluttered landscape.
Yeah.
I think what the proposal for the bill has done is allowed us to look, step back and look at that and see the landscape as it lies and think, right, where are the areas where we think we need to do some work? Where can we pull it together into one tangible process? Whether that's a plan, I think a plan is too siloed to use the term, but I think whether it's you know, making the process better, and I think that's why when we picked up two areas that are in the bill already, we were already working on those as well, so we can see, you know, the merit in all of that, but it is a bit of a cluttered landscape and I think we need to tidy that up.
Minister, I welcome your observation that we have a clutter in many policy areas, and this is certainly one of them. One of our earlier witnesses described this as a legislative salad, and there seems to be an awful lot on the plate. I think that's part of our problem.
Salad is good for you sometimes, apparently.
Indeed, I should.
And I'm going to move to supplementary from Mr. Mara, please.
Thank you, Convener. I mean, you've talked a little bit about the current accountability structures, both to ministers, and you know, seem to be saying that these are working, and you feel it's the most effective way for these to work. And we've talked about the existing policy regime, but I mean, you would recognise the scale of failure: 4,000 young people a year, by some estimates. Previous evidence said perhaps up to 800,000 young people requiring action. People falling off a cliff, they tell us, feel like they're going into an abyss. They're half as likely to be employed, 44.4% economically inactive against 16.1%. I mean, these statistics are really stark. I suppose, my question is, how long do we persist with the approach that you're taking before you decide that something different needs to happen? Previous evidence said a year would be enough to evaluate that. Would you agree?
So we're already doing that. We've already recognised that issue. We have taken forward a number of pieces of work, including that analysis, which will be published in the next few weeks. We have recognised some of the issues arising from the bill and picked that up. We have decided to do some work around about what does a good transition look like, because actually some people do have good transitions, and we're using that experience in order to create a standard where people will have that. We're working very closely with ARC, who you heard from this morning, on the work that they're doing. We are very much taking the approach of, we understand there's challenges here, we know there's issues, we know there's excellent practice out there, how do we make that much more consistent? And I think that's where we're moving forward. So we recognise all of those challenges, we don't shy away from them, and we are working towards doing that. But the key part of that is working with organisations like ARC and the key stakeholders, because unless the process is informed by that lived experience, you know, we may be back here soon.
My question was, how long?
So the principles into practice work is, Pathfinders are finishing in March, so just a short few weeks away, and we should be in a position to publish the analysis on the literature review that we've done in the coming weeks as well. So pretty soon you will see much more detail around this.
Thank you, Camille.
Thank you on that. Thank you for your comments there, both of you, on the general principles of the bill. We do, and we've heard again about how that would then translate into resource implications if they were there. So has the government decided yet if it's looking to lodge a motion to agree the financial resolution on the bill? So, Minister Hoy first.
Thank you. So, you know, a number of stakeholders, including COSLA, have queried the proposed estimation of the uptake and costs and their response to the calls for evidence, and suggested that the cost in the financial memorandum underestimate the cost to implement the bill. Some of those have provided evidence to the committee. I'm aware that has already highlighted that. I know that in earlier panels, concerns have been raised about attrition assumptions in the financial memorandum in respect of young people having a transitions plan in place. And we also note that the financial memorandum only costs ongoing support plans for disabled young people who are not in education, employment or training once they've left school, rather than all disabled young people, which is contrary to how the bill is currently drafted. So we would therefore welcome further evidence and analysis of the figures provided and the estimated uptake of transition plans to help the government inform the government's position regarding the financial implications of the bill, convener.
Thank you for that response. Can I move to questions now from Ross Greer, please?
Thanks very much, convener. And just before moving on to my line of questions, just specifically on that point, because I think the financial memorandum issue is quite an important one. We'll obviously take evidence from Ms Duncan Glancy on the bill, but what engagement has the government had so far on that specific issue of the financial memorandum and getting that additional information that you've identified as being needed?
So I met with Ms Duncan Glancy late last year. I can't remember exactly when it was, November, December, I think, and Ms McKelvey met with her then too. We did, at that meeting, raise our concerns about the financial memorandum as presented. She did say that she would do some further work on that, and I think she was at that point, if my memory serves me correctly, she was continuing to engage with COSLA on some of the figures.
Cool, identifies a line of questioning for that point in our committee process. I'd like to take a little bit of a step back from transitions specifically, because a lot of the evidence we've taken obviously is the wider landscape for young people with additional support needs and how their experience then feeds into those points of transition. It's been 2 years since the Morgan review now, and I think we would all recognise that the challenges in this bill, but the core motivation behind it say that there is a significant problem right now, and whilst there is good practice elsewhere and some improvements, if you're a family, if you're a young person who's having a very poor experience right now, it doesn't feel to you like there's been much of an improvement. So I suppose my challenge to you is, what can the government point towards in the 2 years since the Morgan review to say this is significant progress we have made off the back of that review, not just specifically on transition, but the wider context that then feeds into that transition experience?
So we published our action plan with COSLA and ADES in October 2020 in response to Angela Morgan's review, and that set out the actions that we'd take to implement the ESL review's recommendations. We published an updated action plan and a progress report in November last year, and that highlighted that 24 of the actions had been fully completed. We continue to work closely with local government partners through the Additional Support for Learning Project Board to deliver the remaining actions, which we've committed to by the end of this Parliament, so March 2026. And we've also committed to updating progress again in spring 2024, so that we're able to evidence that we have been taking action. You know, I think we recognise there's much more we need to do to ensure that the current legislative duties in this area are implemented consistently and effectively for disabled children and young people. While Angela Morgan's review didn't consider that new legislation in this area was necessary, we're focused on that delivery of non-legislative solutions, as I said, during the course of this Parliament, and that's where the work that we're doing in the ARC pilots is absolutely key, along with other strands of work, but under the strategy for improving transitions for disabled children and young people. So we're not resting on our laurels, Mr. Gray.
Absolutely. I think you can see that in the revisions that have been made to the ASL plan in that two-year period. They've been gradually getting more ambitious. That being said, there's an awful lot in that plan that is an objective to meet with X stakeholder, bring together Y group of stakeholders, start a discussion about Z. They're not actions that you can then clearly measure the impact of. You can tick a box here. You mentioned 24 of these have been done already. It's very easy to convene a meeting and therefore say, you know, objective met, everybody's been around the table and talked about it. That's not the outcome we're obviously looking for here. The outcome we want is a more positive experience for the young person with the additional need, for their school, for their family, etc. Do you think that the ASL action plan, even with the most recent revision, is as ambitious as the government's overall ambitions for young people with additional needs? Are your ambitions reflected in the plan as it currently stands?
So I think we all want to be more ambitious and go further and faster and quicker and improve things. But we have to do that at a pace that stakeholders are comfortable with, that we're not just putting plans in place for the sake of putting plans in place, that we actually have to have the evidence and the research behind that and trialling those things and seeing what works, which is what the pilots, the ART pilots, are doing and giving us the evidence of. I think if you look at it, you know, I've got some statistics in front of me which do show improvement for attainment and initial leaver destinations for transitions for secondary school and special school leavers. And I'm happy to provide those to the committee as one piece of data that we can point to say we can see improvement here. But I think the additional support for learning and the Morgan Review are part of a plethora of work that we're doing to improve transitions. And as Christina McKelvey alluded to, some of that work is coming to its conclusion, some of those pilots are coming to its conclusion, and we'll be able to point to that and say this is the difference that these things make and this is why we want to expand on those, or this does not work and so it's this isn't a system that we want to continue working through.
Taking on board your point that the ASL action plan is only part of a wider landscape, and we've already talked about how cluttered that landscape might be, once the ARC pilots are completed, I think that provides a valuable data set. There's other data sets being gathered. Should we expect in the next revision of the action plan more quantifiable actions in there, stuff that we can measure? Because I think the difficulty for Parliament at the moment is looking at the action plan and progress between each set of revisions. It's hard to quantify that, and I accept that not everything we're talking about here is easily quantifiable. People's lives aren't that simple. But at the same time, we have a duty to make sure that we're scrutinising the progress the government's making, and the action plan at the moment is quite hard to scrutinise in that respect. So if you were to commit that the next revision of that action plan will include some more measurable outcomes, I think that would make Parliament's role here a lot easier.
Yeah, I can come in on that. I know you heard from Mark this morning, and no doubt they expressed to you some of the key achievements that they feel have been made along the way. One of the key parts of that is the development of a framework that can be used by all sectors, and that's one of the key issues that we have to tackle here is sometimes we have different sectors who have different assessments, who have different plans. Actually, something that works across sectors is really, really important, so and being able to adapt to those specific local situations and need, because as you said, no single young person's set of needs or characteristics are the same. So you kind of do a bit of a blanket policy here. One of the other things that they spoke about was that improved engagement with young people, and I think another key achievement of that is to have young people, parents and carers, both who have experienced good transitions and who have maybe not experienced such good transitions, and assessing the outcomes for them. So that bit of work is ongoing as well. Improved communication and partnership, I think, is another key part of that. But the other key part is continuing to develop the data collection and sharing function within Compass. And I think that's a key piece of work that we're working on as well. And that has demonstrated through each of its iterations how more important that has become. On the top of that, we also have the Equality Data Improvement Project, which has been a piece of work done by the Chief Statistician, which has led to consultation on data improvement plans for every part of government. So that collecting, understanding, disaggregation and use of data to target it, those key issues are really important here. And I know it sounds quite dry, but you need that information in order to ensure that that first piece of work, the framework, works in those local and specific need settings as well. So I see that as key progress. Maybe there's a way that we should be articulating that a bit more, and we'll have a think about that when we leave today. But I do think that we have made key progress, and we can see that there. We've been enshrined in this piece of work, so maybe we're seeing our way, we can see it. So there's maybe a bit of work that we need to just demonstrate that progress as well.
That's great. Thanks very much. Thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you very much. Stephanie Callaghan, over to you now, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. Just wanted to ask about the individual living funds briefly. We've heard from quite a few people that they weren't aware of individual living funds. Some of them found out by accident, and there were other organisations who were very, very up on individual living funds and had quite a lot of people coming forward and applying for them and getting quite good funding from that. So a couple of things. Is that the fairest way to actually do it? Is it something that's possibly going to be reviewed, or should it possibly be smaller grants that actually go out to a wider range of people? Because I can imagine that as awareness around it increases, that actually demand for it will increase as well, and that would create funding pressures. Thanks.
I'm just getting the most up-to-date information for you on that. So this has been used since December 2017, and around about £10 million has been awarded to 5,300 grant recipients. So you can see, you know, the depth and the spread of that. Single-year grants are up to £4,000 right now, and young people can apply for whatever activity or equipment that they need to support and achieve the outcomes that are important to them. And that ties into my last response to Ross Greer about how individualised these plans need to be, and in some cases then that funding opportunity comes along with that. I've seen young people using it for driving lessons, I've seen young people using it for music lessons or equipment that they need, or just education courses or other things that actually enrich your life that are maybe not available to other young people.
It's great, you know, when people actually have the awareness and they're putting in the applications to get that kind of funding there as well. But it seems to be really quite uneven. There's people that don't know about it. There's other people that do know about it. And it's more about, actually, is that getting the balance right there as well? Or should it be broadened out? And should it be something that we're looking at making available to everyone? Now, I know anyone can apply for it just now, but what I mean is that everybody kind of almost automatically kind of having access into that.
No, it's an absolutely spot-on point, and we know of lots of things that are available right across the whole of Scotland, but you'll always talk to somebody who said, I didn't know about that, you know? So I think as part of the Pathfinder work that we are doing and the work that we are doing to raise awareness, the work this committee is doing and the work the Bill's doing to raise awareness is really important in all of this as well. And your own work, because you've just raised the issue on the public record of independent living fund grants, and lots of folk will realise that as well. There's obviously a role for government here now to ensure that people know that that's available and the things that they can use it for, which can be really, really diverse and really exciting, and just give that extra bit of diversity to someone's maybe more prescripted life because of their disability. So it just gives them a bit of freedom. I'll take that away and have a look at how we can incorporate the raising awareness of funds and other support like this as part of the next steps.
Thanks.
Referring back to our previous panel, you don't know what you don't know. Okay, again. So can I move on to some questions now from the Vice Convener, Co-Cab Stewart, please.
Thank you. Good morning, Ministers. I'm just going to try and finish off what the government's doing at the moment, and then I'm going to move on to looking at the definition of disabilities regarding the Equalities Act. So that's my 2 points. So the first bit, you've actually probably already given us a very clear indication of the work that the government is already doing to address the disability transitions for our young people and children. But I just wanted to make sure to put on the record, was there anything else that is going on that we should be aware of? I mean, you have actually been quite thorough, but it was just to make sure. I was interested also about the principles into practice pilot. You've indicated that the initial report of that is coming out soon. And I just wondered if there was any emerging sort of like indication or evidence of the impact. I mean, we heard this morning that it's looking pretty positive, but I just wondered if there was any further information on that. Thank you.
So if I can start on that one, Christine, if that's all right. So in terms of other work that Scottish Government is doing, so I know the committee's heard about GIRFEC and the how that can be used to support transitions for disabled children and young people. We're absolutely committed to fully embedding GIRFEC. As the committee will know, it's internationally recognised, it's been internationally replicated, locally embedded, positively embraced by practitioners, and I know that from my own previous practice, how valuable that is in terms of a shared language and shared plans across health and social care. We refreshed the GIRFEC policy and practice guidance materials last year. That was launched in September last year. And we are in the initial work starting to refresh GIRFEC guidance on transitions, and that will be the next week. Sorry, I can. And I'm happy to keep the committee updated on that, because that's obviously a piece of work that I'm sure will be relevant right across the remit of the committee. There's also the work that Scottish Government started doing on GIRFI, getting it right for everyone, and I know the committee heard about some of that when we did our session on the National Care Service. So there is work going on in terms of other areas of supporting disabled children and young people, but also everyone. This is about supporting everyone, being person-centred and having a universal offer. Christina, is there anything you want to add?
Maybe just a quick update on the Equality Act and the work that does. We've obviously got 9 protected characteristics across that. One of the things that I work very closely on is where the intersections of all of those are, because you're generally not one defined characteristic. You're generally a collection of those, and it's where those intersect is where we find the deepest inequalities. So that's one aspect of the Equality Act provisions that we are thinking about when we move this forward. When it comes to definition, it's pretty wide. And in the bill, it's pretty wide as well. That's one of the issues that we are tackling, because some people will be happy to self-identify in the characteristic that they have. Others aren't. And when it comes to young people, sometimes they don't want to do that. So we've got a bit of work. I think Pam Duncan-Glancy's got a bit of work to do in the bill to define that a bit more closely and who would be accessing both the plans, the services and all of that as well. And you'll find, actually, in schools, you will know this from your professional background, that teachers generally don't wait for a diagnosis or a self-declaration to understand a young person struggling and therefore put the support measures into place. So we already have that excellent work going on in schools. I think what we need to do is to ensure that is defined in a better way, understandable to all professionals. And it comes back to the point I made earlier to Ross Greer about how important that plan is to be able to be used across multiple sectors, and then the young person and supported through their whole journey rather than just one part of the journey as well. So the definition in the Equality Act is pretty wide.
It is, yeah, I mean, I see it as quite a challenge as well on that wideness. And we've taken evidence before and looked at, because it covers mental health as well and different conditions that can change at different points in a person's life. So that sort of like age group between 16 and 25, 26, it covers, it touches different things at different points, and how you identify that and ensure the consistency, but I'm sure you'll be well aware of that. The last point was just about the challenge to local authorities.
Can I just come in there very briefly? Sure. And just on the back of what Christine McKelvey is saying there, the bill looks at disability, whereas the other plans that we have in transitions look at additional support needs, which may be short term, which may be acute. It could be in response to family bereavement. It could be a child whose first language is not English, who would be supported through transitions as things are. But the bill doesn't look at those issues. Its definition, wide though it is, also narrows down on who would be who would have a statutory right or a legal right rather. To a plan and to a transition plan.
That actually, that takes me very nicely onto the point I was just going to finish on, was the challenge of identification. So obviously people who work with our young people, they're very good at picking that up. However, not always. So we have considered that, is that if you don't self-identify, if you're afraid of stigma or for whatever reason, then that compulsion on local authorities is like, well, you know, there are kids there and you're not taking care of them, but then how do you identify them with that? So that is a concern. Thank you.
Okay. Can I move to questions now from Graham Day, please?
Thank you, Convener. However important and necessary they might be, I guess a lot of people, when they hear about new strategies and refreshes of strategy, they will roll their eyes, because what they're actually looking for is real practical change that will improve the experiences of themselves and their loved ones. And we've heard through our evidence that there's a lot of little things that could be done that cumulatively, if I can get the word out, would make such a huge difference to the experience of individuals going through transition. And one of the things that specifically we mentioned multiple times has been a lack of documentation to follow a young person that explains their needs, what they require, what it is they react badly to, and that at whatever stage of transitions they're going through, they have to keep telling this story over and over again. And I just want to explore this thing about documentation, because I'm aware of what's called a communication passport that's been developed by mycompass.com. It's actually in operation in at least one school in my area. And I know the Deputy First Minister, John Swinney, has championed this particular document. I'm just wondering if you're aware of that document. I have a copy of it here as it pertains to a young constituent of mine. And whether it's something that you feel would be worth exploring for a sort of nationwide rollout. Because it's all very well and good this being available in some localities and some individuals. But if we've got something here that works, is it not something, an example of that, one of the many little things we could do to improve things?
Yeah, oh, it's a great question, and it's one of those long-term issues that we always have about what follows a young person as they move through each stage of their life, and how informed is that when it moves through. I am aware of your constituents. I believe she had a petition on this piece of work on that. Actually, there's quite a few passports out there, so we do have a number of them. So we've got the Compass one that I've mentioned already, and we've got PAMIS, who have a digital passport, and then of course the ARC Scotland one. And again, if you apply for the ILF fund, there's you know, access there to other services, just for the dint of having the funds to do that as well. I think one of the things that obviously we've looked at is all of these great opportunities and develops across different organisations, and I think ARC have been pulling that together, and that's where Compass comes in, and the fact that it's got this is a bit more detailed than just about you know, what a young person needs and what should be the next steps. It's actually really well informed by the young person, the people around them, their parents and their carers, and I think that's really important, because again, you could have a blanket approach to this and a bit of a tick box exercise, but that is definitely not what any of these young people need, and that's where I think the new Compass passport that's been developed is
excellent one for that. I think the one that your constituent is involved with is excellent. So is the PAMAS one as well. So I think we need to look at actually people are having a bit of a choice here about the one that will work for them as well, but actually how informed is it and how practical and worthy is it when you move from one transition to the other, and whether it makes that whole process seamless or easier. We would prefer seamless, but maybe easier. And then the next iteration of the people who are surrounding that young person is able to pick that up and carry on. And for some young people, it's just the familiarity is incredibly important in this aspect as well. And all of these passports take that into account.
If I can follow up on that, convener, I mean, are we talking all of these being a living document that the young person and the parents, carers, can input to as time goes on? And also, to what extent would you be prepared to require bodies to take account of the content? Because it's all very well and good having that, but if the relevant body is just saying, well, thanks for that, and they're actually not acting upon it, then it doesn't really serve a purpose. So I'm trying to get into the nitty-gritty of this, because it's got a lot of potential, and it's good to hear that there are multiple options, but it needs to be something that the relevant people are feeding into, and then it needs to be implemented.
So the What Is My Communications Passport Scheme, Scottish Government funded the development of that for it to be available on Education Scotland's resource hub. So it's there for anybody to have a look at. What it does do is it aligns with the additional support for learning duties. So it places those duties for individualised support into that plan. And that gives you the equality duty minimum where people should have those supports in place. It also sits in the context of the learning and support plans and coordinated support plans, individualised education programmes and child plans. So just within that, you've got all of those plans and it brings much of that together. But those duties underpin all of that. And I think we don't have a huge amount of information about how widely the passport model is used, and I think that's a piece of work that will come out of the Pathfinder about how we use the passport model. The other aspect of work that I'm involved in is the review of the public sector equality duty, how that will work alongside the new Human Rights Bill for Scotland, and how that underpins the rights of all people in Scotland, and particularly young people in these settings, to ensure that they're getting what they deserve.
And of course, from a practical sense, the existence of these kind of passports should be hugely helpful to the very bodies who are interacting with these young people.
Yeah, one of the issues that we had was about that same issue about maybe a professional in one local authority saying, well, I've got this, another local authority says, well, I've got something different, or an organisation says, I've got this. That's why it was really important to fund the development work for it to go on the Educational Resources Hub, because it, in a sense, it standardises it in a way, but it makes it available to all professionals in educational settings, particularly in order to address some of those needs.
OK, thanks. That's very reassuring. Thanks, Kavir.
Thank you. Ministers, we've heard already about it being a whole life change, a transition, and there's different touch points throughout a person's life and where they may need to dip in and out of that transition. So there's a couple of things I want to ask, specifically a sort of more unilaterally about how the government has explored access to that support can be made at more consistent across different services and in particular times, for example, going to universities and colleges and further education, but also being mindful that there's a range of support and activities and opportunities that may help a transition at various points and or leaving school, not just about going on to that further education. So how have those been considered in ensuring that they get to live really fulfilling lives? Perhaps, do you want to come in first, Claire Hawkey?
Yes, convener, if that's all right. So under the Additional Support for Learning Act, local authorities have a duty to plan for a young person's transition as they leave school. There's also the Social Care Service Directed Support Scotland Act 2013 that aims to ensure that care and support is delivered in a way that supports choice and control over your own life. In terms of other areas, we've heard about the Independent Living Fund from Stephanie Callaghan, the Scotland Transition Fund, and the opportunities that that presents. There's also opportunities in further and higher education that the committee has already heard about in previous evidence sessions. Employability services to support delivery of a No One Left Behind approach, including local delivery of the Young Persons Guarantee. And through the Young Persons Guarantee, our ambition to provide all young people, including disabled young people, with opportunities into work, to training, to education, enterprise or to formal volunteering. We've invested £23.5 million into Fair Start Scotland delivery in this last year, and that provides intensive personalised pre-employment and in-work support for unemployed disabled people and those with health conditions or other barriers to progressing work. And in schools, we have the Developing Young Workforce, which begins in schools, which is facilitated through Skills Development Scotland and Careers Advice. But I think it's important to recognise that, that support is different for everyone and for young people, and they will have different needs, different ambitions, different wants. So it's about having a tailored approach to what that young person's ambitions in their life are.
I understand that fully, and we've heard at length about that uniqueness that every individual has anyway. But again, we've also heard that there's quite a variation in different establishments and how they engage and take part and offer and interact with these people through the transition. So in terms of delivering that consistency, I think what you've outlined is how complex the situation, the legislative salad is that we have. There we go, I'll use that again. But what are you doing now to help drive consistency? And I don't mean consistency in delivering everyone the same thing, but it's making sure that each individual gets exactly the same outcome that's best for them.
Yeah, it's obviously a key aspect, and a key aspect if it's further in higher education. The Scottish Funding Council in particular have developed a national equality outcome framework, and that was to address some of the most persistent inequalities, especially in further and higher education institutions. And they were asked to consider and report as part of the 2021-2025 public sector equality duty reporting cycle. So we've asked them to do that piece of work and come back to us. Disability is a protected characteristic in whatever organisation or public authority you are liaising or working with. They should be ensuring that that work is being done, and the duty on protected characteristics should always be included in the work that they do. So rather than being a tick box exercise at the end of your process, it should be intrinsic to a part of the process, and that's where the national equality outcomes come into force, particularly around about disabled students. They need to give us some indication of both retention and success, of how they are going to improve mental health outcomes and how they're going to improve just general conditions as well as other aspects of that. So that's one key area where a young person could be transitioning into the adult world, whether it's further and higher education, where there's a specific duty in place and a reporting cycle in which those institutions have to report back to us on, and we use all of that data in order to look at where the key inequalities are and tackle those directly.
And if a young person isn't wanting to seek that further education route, what are we doing to drive that range that's really available to them, so they're not being, and I'll apologise for the clumsy language, it's not the tick box to get them to that positive destination for the purposes of reporting, but we want it to be a positive destination for that young person. So what are we doing to help facilitate that and give the diverse opportunities and the range that every other individual has in their life choice?
I think that's a really important point, convener, and that's where planning really comes in, where we need to be looking at planning at all stages of a child or young person's life, and ensuring that they have the opportunity that they want, as opposed to us using, and it's a government term, a positive destination. The positive destination is when that young person gets to the point that they want to be, rather than that we envisage as a higher further education college course or work. So I think that's a really important point that you make, and that's why that planning through school, giving people opportunities to experience different things and make choices in their life is really key.
Can we go over to Stephanie Callaghan? I might have another further question, but we'll pass over to you first.
Yeah, so just kind of picking up on what Sue's talking about here, and probably touching back on other stuff as well. We're talking about consistency, and it can be really difficult to look at consistency when you're looking across people that have got really, really different needs there. And what I'm wondering is, OK, we're great at measuring positive outcomes, we're really good at collating a lot of different data, but what I'm wondering is, what is it we're actually doing, or is there a focus just now in this on actually measuring the things that matter to the individual and doing that every single time? So what I mean is, how does that individual feel that they're progressing towards their aspirations and whatever their life goals are? And I suppose that kind of brings us back full circle to a degree to having, you know, individuals that they've got relationships with that they can rely on, and that it's not a single transition, it's something that develops over time. But how are we going to, or how can we look at including how they feel they're moving towards their aspirations? Because surely at the end of the day, that's what really, really matters, is the individual's experience.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's the toughest part of it. And a life before politics, I specifically had that job of supporting young people from child services into adult services, and particularly into employment volunteering opportunities and work experience. It's always been a tough landscape to work in, because it's governed separately by the Equality Act, separate piece of legislation in order to do that. But I think there's a number of areas where we support many organisations to create opportunities, especially around about supported employment, because like any other young person, you don't set your mind to something and you follow that path, you know. You change your mind, you know, you decide that you want to do something different, or you decide you want to be involved in something else. And that's where organisations like Reemploy and others all come into play with their superb work they do, developing a young workforce, working very closely with some of these specialist organisations as well to create those better outcomes as well. But it comes back to the point that
what I'm really, really interested in is, you know, actually measuring every single time how that individual is viewing their own progress and viewing their own outcomes.
Yeah, it's again a difficult point, but a very relevant point to take on, and that's where some of this working with in partnership with some of these organisations are key, because for some young people they disappear off into their life, and they don't want to be tracked or monitored either. So when we work very closely with these organisations, we're able to do some of that and ensure that, you know, a young person's getting the opportunities that they want to access, but within that sort of a protected environment. Out in the world of employment, there's obviously support available there, but again, it's difficult to track, because if you haven't been supported by your trade union, for instance, or a trade union learning programme, or, you know, other agencies that do support, it's really difficult to track that young person's progress. And some of them don't want to come back and tell you either. So it's the element of choice here, and getting the balance right between the info and the data that we need in order to do that monitoring, and not overly intruding in somebody's life as they move on into the big world.
Thank you.
Indeed, that's some of the evidence we heard earlier on about that touch point, as and when they need to come in and out of the process. I've got one final question for the panel this afternoon. Thank you, Ministers. It would be good if we could get some detail, or specificity, if that's the word, on the timeline for the development and the publication of the national strategy. Minister.
I can give you some of this. So obviously, we've said in this parliamentary term, which was PFG commitment, but if you've heard this morning, there's a huge amount of progress going on. We have the Pathfinder work coming to a conclusion in March, which is just a few short weeks away, and we have the literature review across other
Nations being published very soon as well. So as far as timeline goes, that's the next steps, and they're pretty imminent. As far as a longer scale timeline, that's a bit more difficult to pin down, and we're happy to come back to you once we have those next two steps past us over the next few weeks, to come back to the committee and talk to you more about the timeline, because essentially it's being driven by the children, the young people and the stakeholders who are going to take forward that next piece of work as well. So we don't want to create too tough a timeline that they feel as if it's just they can't access it in their terms, and we'd obviously want to ensure that we have the broadest scope of young people, their parents, their carers and the organisations in there, which means people, you know, who have communication difficulties and other challenges. We want to make sure we give them the time and the space, and more importantly the opportunity to have their voice heard in that. So sorry I can't give you definitive dates and times, but March is a key point for both those other pieces of work and those two next steps.
Thank you. I suppose that reflects the complex landscape that we're working in and all the different stakeholders we have. But I think as a committee, we would look to have something coming back with some idea of time. I think it would give us some reassurance, certainly, as to the progress of things that are going on.
We'd be happy to look at that. Yeah.
Thank you very much. So with that, I'd like to thank you all for your time today. And the public part of today's meeting is now at an end. We will now consider our final agenda items in private. Thank you and good morning.